Well, it's time for our coverage of the NHRA Powerade Drag Racing Series. As many of you know, some may not, this is a tape-delayed coverage that is collected and compressed from throughout the day. We tell you that because during the second round of Funny Car, there was a serious accident that involved Kenny Bernstein and John Forrest. John Forrest over there on the right side, Mike Dunn.
You're going to see Kenny Bernstein going to cross over the center line, send some parts and pieces over there. But what happens was a tire went down on John Force's car, it appears, and when he pulled the parachutes, it just ripped the back half of that chassis off. He is over on the right side of the wall. You see the remainder of the car, the front half of it, sliding down the guard wall in the right-hand lane but before it comes to a stop in the sand trap. Take a look at it. You're going to see Kenny's got... is ahead at this point, but it drifts over, hits the blocks. Now what happens when the chutes come out right there, you're gonna see the chassis where John is actually is off to the left. The other part of the chassis slides over into Kenny's lane. You see John right there as it came to a hard stop against the wall. Very frightening incident at that point.
And we'll look at it one more time as Kenny Bernstein drifts toward the center line, catches the blocks, and then all of a sudden it begins to disintegrate.
Right there, that's John right there. He just pulls the back of that chassis right off. The front part of the chassis goes into Kenny, drives both of them into the wall, and then the bodies are shedded. At that point, Kenny see with both chutes out, he's getting that thing back under control safely. The rest of John's car sliding, like we said, against the wall, and then the part where John is parked over into that left-hand wall.
Kenny Bernstein was shaken up, but okay. And as of 6 o'clock local time, we have an update on John's condition. He will go into surgery tonight at Baylor Hospital. He has a compound fracture of his left ankle. This comes from the team. His right knee has an abrasion all the way down to the bone, and therefore some possible tendon damage. John's left wrist is dislocated and broken, and he has abrasions and broken fingers on his right hand. They did give John Forrest a CAT scan, and it has come back negative. That's the latest on this situation. Now we begin our tape-delayed coverage. This ESPN production is available on ESPN2 HD, presented by Sharp Aquas. Well, things are big here in Texas. Big crowds. And for the racers, Texas had some big disappointments. Robert Height, number one in Funny Car, failed to qualify. Big and bad for Robert. At 6'4", Doug Herbert is a big man with big trouble. Fifth in the countdown, he didn't make it into the top fuel field. Well, the pressure is the biggest for Pro Stock Motorcycle. Today is their last race in the countdown. After finals, four will be eliminated, and only four will be left for the countdown to one. All big reasons to sit back, strap in, and enjoy. And here are the big stories. We start with John Kernan.
Well, it's now or never for Pro Stock Motorcycle rider Craig Treble. And talk about an underdog in the countdown. He squeaked his way in the final countdown position, then went out and won Indy. He now sits third and holds his own countdown destiny in his hands. If he beats Angel Sampan the first round, he's all but secured a spot in the countdown to one. Angel, on the other hand, is a three-time champ with her back against the wall. First, she has to get by Treble, only to face a possible second-round matchup with points leader Andrew Hines. Basically, she must win today to have a shot at her fourth championship. Now to Dave Reif.
The big matchup in the countdown to four in Funny Car round one today has to be Jack Beckman and Tony Pedregon. And for Jack Beckman, this guy is riding a high. A runner-up in Memphis, he's moved from fifth to second in points, the highest he's been all season long. He was a rookie here a year ago, and now he'd like to finish his first full season, possibly as a champion. To do that, he'll have to take out a champion, the 0-3 titleist Tony Pedregon, who's 7 points out of the countdown after sliding from third to fifth after a round one defeat against Ron Capps. He knows another one here would be detrimental. Funny Car, oh yeah, it's big time today. It's the seasoned veteran and the relative newcomer coming up. Gary Gerald.
And in Pro Stock Car, we've got another mega matchup involving countdown contenders in a first-round face-off as Jake Coughlin goes against Larry Morgan. It is particularly, critically important for Larry Morgan because he is seventh in the countdown standings. He is three rounds out of the fourth and final available position in this phase of the countdown to the championship. A loss for Morgan today would be devastating to his title hopes. Clearly, this new playoff format that the NHRA has instituted this year has seen a significant toll taken on some prominent names. And guess what? The surprises and the unexpected just keep on coming.
Coming into Dallas, Doug Herbert was the Cinderella story. He nabbed the eighth and the final position in the countdown to the championship with an improbable win in Reading. In the two races since then, Herbert has jumped from that eighth spot all the way up to fifth. He came to Dallas with momentum, but this is a fickle sport, and the fates decided he would not qualify. And now, for Doug Herbert, the situation is desperate. And it just shows you again how quickly things can happen in the countdown.
Absolutely. That DNQ with Doug Herbert, I mean, it's pretty much over. He's going to have a lot of help from the guys in front of him going out early, particularly Brandon Bernstein. He's going to want to have a chance at it going into Richmond.
And it is time. The engines are fired. The crowd's on its feet. And we're going to see what's going to happen in the countdown now. First pair up will be Alan Bradshaw and Whit Bazemore. Bazemore does have an interest in the countdown. Well, here is the top fuel ladder for you, and we've got just an enormous matchup coming up with Hot Rod Fuller and Tony Schumacher.
Boy, and that is definitely a huge matchup if you look at some of the other ones, including Dixon and Grubnick. And on the other side, some big matchups. Line now, Alan Bradshaw and Whit Bazemore, with Alan Bradshaw having the lane choice.
Well, welcome. We hope you enjoy your day. I'm Paul Page with Mike Dunn, who has won at this very track in both Funny Car and in Top Fuel. You know, we've been talking a lot about the importance of number four, getting into the countdown and making the cut. Well, let's talk for a minute about the importance of number one. Robert Height came here number one, then he failed to qualify. That number one is going to help him stay within that battle. But then coming up, as we just showed you, we've got a matchup with number one and number two, Schumacher and Fuller.
Well, absolutely. And if you talk about Hot Rod Fuller's position, you know, if he gets beat in the first round, he probably will be able to stay into the top four. That's the big picture. But on the other hand, you got to remember, when we get to Richmond, the points are going to be condensed. After Richmond, the top four are going to be within 30 points. That's a round and a half of racing with eight rounds to go for the championship. So this is going to be key for both of these drivers to get a win.
And as we have seen, things happen so fast, especially in this countdown. First pair is down the track, and Whit Bazemore becomes the first round winner of the day. Runs a 4:55, 327. Series giant crowd. Look at those skies, though. They are overcast. That may make for some big speed today as we are ready to begin the 20th of our 23 events, the O'Reilly Fall Nationals from the beautiful Texas Motorplex. Magnificent all-concrete drag strip. Next pair coming up to the line. We take a look at Morgan Lucas, who will face Brandon Bernstein. There's Morgan. You saw Brandon earlier. Again. Brandon is the one who has the biggest issues in the countdown. Let's go to Dave Reed.
Paul, as you said earlier, motivation takes many forms. Hot Rod, you said on NHRA race day this morning, you're PO'd about the points lead. What are you going to do about it now?
Just do what we can do. I'm going to do my job. My team's a great team, and they're going to do what they're going to do. And I don't know where that little extra piece of motivation comes from, but it doesn't matter. I'm focused. I'm ready. These guys are ready. And I'll get this cat car in the second round and get my points lead back.
Yeah, it's been kind of fun to watch them go back and forth, all of the racers, on how they feel about the countdown. Here are the best of friends. Both are grads out of that Darien Meadows A-Fuel dragster, Morgan Lucas. Third race in a row that he has had lane choice. And Brandon Bernstein, who grew up here in Texas and won this race last year, but has only three round wins in a countdown to four.
And we talk about the lane choice in the first pair out. Alan Bradshaw had it. He chose that left-hand lane, putting Whit Bazemore in that right-hand lane. But we saw what Whit did. Made a great pass at that 4:55 elapsed time. That's got to make Brandon Bernstein and his crew chief Tim Richards feel awfully good. They're not going to take anything for granted, but they know the track conditions are there. Morgan Lucas in the other lane, same thing. Let's go up there, boys, and just give them a good race. Clean start. No smoking. See what happens.
Lucas pulls the red line. Lowest ET of the race for Brandon.
Well, what happened with Brandon there, you saw him try to go in shallow and actually blink that stage light. I got to believe that probably threw Morgan off. We've seen that happen with Robert Height the other way last week when his competition did the same thing and threw Robert off, giving him a late start. It's really hard, man. You're up there trying to concentrate on everything and that stage light blinks. A lot of times you're going to see one driver get thrown off by it. It looked like that time it might have possibly been Morgan Lucas.
So, Brandon Bernstein, and back in the staging lanes, John Kernan has Tony Schumacher.
Tony's getting ready to suit up to get into his Army Top Fuel Dragster. Going up against Hot Rod Fuller, number one, number two in the points. What do you have for him?
Well, we're going to go out and have to run good. I think we're lucky with the conditions, man. We're real good in these conditions. It's a battle. We got a great racing. We know how to do it under crunch pressure, and it's going to be a fantastic race for the fans. You guys, this one's one to watch.
All right, and we'll let him go ahead and get suited up as he gets ready. Number one against number two in the points.
We mentioned the overcast skies, and we'll give you the weather here in Dallas, Texas, really on the south side of Dallas.
Well, and that's the key here. You look at the air temperature, much cooler water grains, a lot more moisture, but the key is that track temperature, 97. We saw it up to 127 degrees in qualifying, and that's the reason we're seeing some great elapsed times in Top Fuel right out of the box.
And down at the far end, Morgan Lucas, the red light. Yeah, he's angry at himself for that red light. We don't see enough of this guy. Joe Hartley, his best season ever in Top Fuel Racing, runner-up at Houston, his first ever final round, number one qualifier at Topeka. Last time we saw him, though, was back at Chicago. In the other lane, it'll be Bob Vandergriff. Again, countdown implications here, but he's had only one round win in the countdown to four. Currently sits sixth.
Bob has moved up to fifth in the points.
Fifth now.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's interesting. So far, the cars that are in the countdown, the first three, have not had lane choice. They've all been put in that right lane, but we see the track is excellent in both lanes, it looks like right now.
Very early on, 4:57 for Bob Vandergriff, that 323 miles an hour for the UPS car, and Bob Vandergriff will advance. We have been talking about the huge matchup, number one and number two, Tony Schumacher and Hot Rod Fuller. Schumacher is 15 points ahead of Fuller. How will they come out at the end of the run?
ESPN's presentation of the O'Reilly NHRA Fall Nationals, brought to you by Powerade. Sport is what you make it. And O'Reilly Auto Parts, better parts at better prices every day. And by Optima Batteries, the ultimate power source.
Later on, LeBron James.
Well, Top Fuel has had three pair go down the track. Of those three pair, those in the countdown have all advanced. And here comes the number one qualifier, J.R. Todd. Last time he raced at Texas, he won. He's 74 points out of fourth. But in the other lane is Clay Milliken. His second start from the bump spot, which is where Clay sits coming here. But, man, you got to think Clay is really due.
He's really due, but he's going to have to run awfully hard to get around J.R. Todd. This J.R. has had a great car in qualifying as you look back at Clay on board. But J.R. Todd, consistent, been quick, different conditions right now, but he also ran very good in the cool conditions on Friday night to give him that number one qualifier position at 4:54, but we've already seen a 4:53 out of Brandon.
Oh,
good race.
Wow. right at the end there. The hole shot win goes to Clay Milliken.
Wow.
On a 461, 327. JR told me yesterday that his back was against the wall, that they had to win, and they have become now the first one in the countdown to not win a matchup.
Well, we talk about the pressure of the countdown with these drivers. I really think the pressure might have got to JR Todd. Uncharacteristic, a 1:13 reaction time. He's usually much better than that. Clay Milliken, man, I mean, he might have took a shot. He was 0:32. Great reaction time. He needed it because a 4:61, even though running slower, look at the margin of victory on our Lucas Oil photo finish, about still about a half a car length with JR Todd coming down hard.
And back up at the line, getting it a little sideways there, is Melanie Troxell, our last winner, who is a spoiler in the countdown, and Corey McLenathan, who won here 96, 97, and 2000. In this Power 8 Power Time, we're going to talk about funny car driver Tommy Johnson Jr. and his wife, top fuel driver Melanie Troxell. This dynamic duo can easily be called the golden couple of the NHRA. Although each has earned success in their respective class, we've watched them both share their victories and their losses. We couldn't help but wonder how they plan to maintain their idyllic relationship next season when they will face one another head on.
Well, next year I'll be driving a second funny car for Mike Ashley, sponsored by Torco Race Fuel, so I'll have the same sponsorship but just moving over to Mike Ashley's team. But the idea behind moving to funny car had a lot more to do about the team, the chemistry, how successful I thought the team was going to be, rather than really about whether it was a funny car or a dragster.
When she asked me about it, I didn't have much comment because I knew it probably didn't matter what I said. She was going to do what she wanted to. I'm learning about this marriage thing quickly. You might voice your opinion, but it really doesn't matter. She'll catch on pretty quickly in all the years, the runs that she's made in top gear, just dealing with the speed. But there's still a lot of learning to do with the wheelbase and the vision and different things that go on in the funny car. It's still different.
I'm going to have to race against my husband, and that's not going to be fun the first time, one of us, we come head, come up to race each other first round, and one of us has to go home early.
We struggled earlier when she started doing really well on top fuel. One have a bad weekend, one have a good weekend, and it's hard to make that work between two people who live in the same place. More so than anything, it's just almost like added aggravation I didn't need,
Tommy and I are very competitive people, and we had to deal with just our competitive nature between the two of us when we first got married, and we learned how to figure that out and learned how to deal with it. So I'm sure it's something that, it's just another challenge that we'll have to learn how to deal with.
We used to talk a lot about driving when we were in different classes about different things, but now that she's in the funny car class, I don't want to give away everything. As much as I love her and want to help her, at the same point, we're not working on the same team.
We're just going to have to be really good about separating the personal part from the race side. We go up there, we're both trying to win that given round, but then we need to be able to let that go at the end of the day, and that's probably going to be the hard part.
And we're driving for different car owners, and we're racing against each other, and I've worked hard to get all that information and all those things. And I mean, if there's a critical situation where she might need a pointer or two, I might give it to her, but on a day-to-day basis, school's out.
Well, all I want to say is I'm glad I don't have to race my wife. I get enough from her as it is.
Yeah, it makes you wonder what's more dangerous, on the track or when you come home.
Yeah. Whew. But look at Melanie. I tell you, she has definitely had the hottest car since the countdown started. Tough break that she's not in racing for it. Six round wins, two more than Tony Schumacher and Brandon Bernstein. She has had an excellent race car.
Yeah, this graphic coming into this race, think about this. If she had made it into the countdown, she'd be sitting third right now. Go back to that decision made at Reading.
Yeah, the decision where they decided to race head-to-head with her teammate Morgan Lucas. I got to give them credit for their integrity. She said if she couldn't beat them, she didn't deserve it. Well, she's not in right now, but still has a good race car and definitely can play the spoiler role with the way she's been running. But right now she's up against Corey McLenathan, one of the best in the business.
Yeah, she went to her first ever top fuel final here in 2000, losing to Corey McLenathan. They both line up. Corey Mack is able to get it back under control. It's a 5:14, 2:56, but Corey Mack takes down Melanie Troxell.
That was a little bit of a surprise with the numbers we've been seeing. I know we saw Joe Hartley spin the tires, but I mean, obviously the track is good. We've seen a number of 450 elapsed times. We take another look at it. Melanie had about almost 7 hundredths of a second advantage off the starting line, but she spun the tires first. Corey went out there a little bit further, did a good job of getting it to recover and got the win. Let's take another look at Melanie right here. You're gonna see right there, just goes into some tire shake and drives up into smoke. She gets out of the car. Look at her head bouncing around there. She tries to get back in and out of that thing. Starts spinning the tires. That's a bucket Bronco there, but Corey just did a better job on that run.
Well, they've now fired up. Hot Rod Fuller and Tony the Sarge Schumacher. They'll be next out. A pair you don't want to miss.
I'm pretty good about pressure, but even the way this championship's structured, it puts a tremendous amount of pressure on you. And, you know, I just got to find ways to, you know, at Indy and Memphis, my team and me both, everybody was kind of really tight. And all season long, we've been really loose and cutting up and having fun. And we weren't like that at those two races. And so the other day we tested at Memphis and we kind of got that fun back. And we all that came this week and we're smiling, having fun. And that's what I think for our team to be able to win and to stay competitive is just to keep loose like that and not let this championship start squeezing us down.
So here they are, Hot Rod Fuller and Tony Schumacher. Whoever wins this takes number one in the points. Hot Rod had a great comment. I earn my points. I did not inherit them.
I like that. But right here, this is the key. Look at the numbers in the head-to-head battles with Tony Schumacher and Rod Fuller. Rod Fuller has struggled when they've come up against Tony Schumacher. But right now, you have very good track conditions. You see the numbers by Schumacher in qualifying. Only qualified number 13. That's kind of big right there. Boy, there's a lot of fuel coming out of that header right there. The biggest problem there is hopefully it's not getting under the tire.
Last time they raced, 2-1.
Cylinder
out right away.
That was a mechanical.
There you go. Hot Rod Fuller takes that win and goes to number one in the points.
Yeah, that's got to be an issue where one of the nozzles was hung open on an idle and just pushing that fuel out into that pipe. Now, that's second week in a row that a mechanical problem has taken out Tony Schumacher. Take another look at fuel. What happens is there's nozzles that go into the intake port that aren't supposed to open up until the driver hits the throttle. What happened is those nozzles, one or at least maybe two of those nozzles in that port was hung open, putting fuel in it, so it never really had any heat in that cylinder. So when Tony hits the throttle right there, it never even had a chance to light that cylinder. And on top of that, it made a right-hand turn, and his day was done right from this get-go.
And then we say it happens fast, and it can be the smallest thing. So there they are, and it's now changed. The man closest to you, Rod Fuller, is now number one in the points. Tony Schumacher drops into second and may drop Fuller before the day is over. Gary Gerald?
Well, Hot Rod, we talked about how big this is. That puts you back into the championship points lead. What kind of satisfaction are you getting for beating him for the first time this season?
It's great, but, you know, he's a great competitor, and I don't like to, you know, it looked like he had some problems up there, and you want to beat somebody fair and square, and I know that was fair and square, but these guys are a great team, and I'd like to, you know, I would like to win with their car running good, so.
Turn, good luck. What'd you run?
I'm not for sure, but
59.
Good run, and, you know, to have our points lead back is great. We got Cat this year, and we got whole Cat and LP, Valvoline. All the rest of the great sponsors, Macco Tools, and a big, big round.
Let's see if we can get Tony.
Tony,
can you come over?
Yeah.
We'll get him over here. They're trying to move the Cat car for Hot Rod, so we're kind of improvising here on the run in a very congested runoff area. Tony, obviously, that one was totally out of your hands. That baby was spitting stuff out the pipes there at the line.
It was. Something was wrong with it, but, you know, that's just the way it goes, man. You got some hunk tires right here, man. These things are chunked. Better be careful. But, hey, for the Army, we got a great team. We're really good under pressure. Something was just wrong there. Felt like something on the right side was just off. You know, I left the start line. That thing just turned right. And all I could do was stop it, get it back, and get going down there. Hope he spun the tires. But whatever. You know, that was a big round. Didn't want to lose that one. But, hey, man, you know, we got a battle ahead of us. Still, we still got another race. We're still in the top four right now. We still got some our two best races coming up. I mean, Vegas and Pomona, man, we're good there.
And let me bring you down here and take a look at the chunk tires that Tony observed. This is on Hot Rod Fuller's left rear.
Back up at the line, you get a good look at Dave Brubnik. He will go alongside Larry Dixon. What about those tires, Mike?
Well, something they'll definitely be taking a look at. They'll have the Goodyear engineers over there, and the teams will take a close look at what's going on there. And what happens a lot of times is the track's very tight, cool conditions. That's when you see the tires chunky more so than on a hot racetrack.
Dave Brubnik was the runner-up here in 04. He's the best Coletta car this year. Larry Dixon won in 2001 from the pole, and the last driver to win Top Fuel here from number one, Dixon, third in the countdown, 15 points behind Fuller as they came to this round. And that, by the way, is who he will face if he can win it. A 4:54.317. Larry Dixon will face Hot Rod Fuller in the quarterfinals.
Wow, that was just a good old drag race there. I mean, both drivers left pretty much dead even. Go on board with Larry Dixon here. Some working the wheel a little bit, trying to keep it in that narrow groove, and he did an excellent job just right at the other end. It looked like possibly a cylinder went out and drove him over towards the wall a little bit, but still a 4:54 gets him into the next round.
And J.R. Todd lost to Clay Milliken, the number 16 qualifier, and Gary, is he a bit upset?
I know, J.R., that this is a very bitter pill to try to swallow. Can you explain the emotion, and does this effectively take you out of the countdown?
I'm sure it does, but you know, we're not giving up. We can't be in the countdown. We might as well spoil it for those who are. And you know, Evan Knoll and Torco and Skullshaw, you know, they give us the money to come out here and win. And you know, there's no worse way for a driver to lose and get spanked on a hole shot like that. And I just didn't do my job. And you know, at least one of Evan's cars is going on to the next round, hopefully going to win this thing. But you know, we'll keep battling out for that number five spot if we don't have a chance to make the countdown. So it is what it is. And you know, We shouldn't have been in this position anyway, but we were, and just let my guys down. It sucks.
J.R. Todd started the day in seventh, 71 points back from Brandon Bernstein, who was in that fourth place. And here come the teammates. Doug Coletta and Hillary Will, the winner of this, will face Bob Vandergrift. Coletta won here in 02. He's only been out of second round one time this year, but he seems to be having a pretty solid weekend, and he feels good about having found some things in the car. Hillary Will, he started 15th at Memphis. Dave Reif.
John Force, less than two rounds out of the countdown to four, trying to get back in there for the second time this season. Not going to have your wingman, Robert Hyde, out today, so it might be something you have to do on your own.
And that hurts. That's why we'll have four funny cars next year. All the data, all the help, every round you can win, taking out the opponent counts. Mike Neff will be back in that Mustang. Robert's out today, but he will leave here in the countdown, hopefully in the lead. We'll get Ashley in this show next year, but right now she can do some damage. And we need to get to the final here. This thing could be over for us, and we're just going to hit them with everything we've got.
Ashley Force will take on Ron Capps. That could definitely help out Ashley's father, John.
.460, 321 miles an hour to a losing .461 for Hillary Will. Maybe he has reason to feel good about that car. In his entire Top Fuel career, he's had at least one win during a season. This season, not yet. So the Lucas Oil Top Fuel ladder as we look ahead to the second round. And again, two guys who are in the countdown will have to face one another, Rod Fuller and Larry Dixon.
The other side, you got Corey Mack going against Whit Bazemore, Doug Coletta and Bob Vandergrift going head-to-head.
So how do the points look now? It's getting so much more important. Hot Rod Fuller moves up to number one, and Bob Vandergrift with a 61 back from Bernstein. Well, that's three rounds. And Brandon Bernstein, he will have to face Clay Milliken, who took out the number one qualifier, J.R. Todd, when they come back. And so they get to work on that machine right away. Coming up, it'll be Funny Car. We've got a huge matchup there as well. Tony Pedregon and Jack Beckman. These guys are fighting it out in the points, and it is part of the ongoing game.
You know, I just thought, I don't think you can describe the pressure of wanting something so bad that that you wake up throwing up, you know, with a sick stomach, but in a good way. I just think that the pressure of that we went through in 05 and 06 is definitely going to help us this year as far as the brute team. I don't see that not being something that we can use.
Now, a bit of a surprise admission by Ron Capps, who sits up number three in the points. You ever feel sick in the morning, Mike, before you race?
Never before I race, but every day when I do TV.
Well, here's the Lucas Oil Funny Car Ladder. Thanks for that, Mike.
I'm there for you.
Interestingly enough, look there, Tim Wilkerson is the number one qualifier again, but look down there, Ron Capps and Ashley Forrest. Ashley, she doesn't have a dog in that countdown fight, except she could help her father out.
She can definitely do that if she can get that win. But the big matchup here on the other side of the ladder, Jack Beckman and Tony Pedregon. Tony Pedregon for sure needs this round win. Jack Beckman also has got a hot race car, so it's going to be tough for Tony. Should be a great race.
And, you know, you'd think if you're in the countdown, you're going to be really careful not to have a DNQ. But look at this list. DNQs since the U.S. Nationals, and on this very weekend, Doug Herbert and Robert Hyde, neither one qualified.
Yeah, just with the countdown to four contenders, and I mean, those are some big names, but that just tells you how tough it is in qualifying with changing track conditions, and you got cars that make 8,000 horsepower in the case of fuel funded cars and top fuel dragsters. I mean, it's a fine line between hitting and making that great run like Tim Wilkerson did for that number one spot with a 478, or going up there and smoking the tires.
Tim Wilkerson, the 10th number one of his career. A lot of sponsors here. He works on the car, drives the car, handles the sponsor. Whoa, and I was so set to say happy birthday, Jerry Tolliver. He turns 56 today, but he does not make it. That 521 gives way to the 483 run by Tim Wilkerson. But thinking ahead, he has not been past second round in all of his trips to Dallas. We'll see how he fares when he comes back. And we go to John Kernan.
Following back in the staging lanes with Tony Pedregon, currently fifth in points, listening to a little 50 Cent and Carlos Santana to get ready for his matchup against number two in the points, Jack Beckman. Tony, you guys looked pretty good yesterday in the heat. You got a setup in here from Dickie Venables for the cloud cover?
Yeah, the conditions have changed. We're probably going to, without question, be dealing with a slightly cooler track temperature. I don't know that the air's gotten better, but no question it's an important round for us. They're a tough opponent, but I'll be ready. My insides are junk right now, and that's a good thing.
All right, he did win here back in 2000, so back to you, Paul.
You ever see that deal with the...
Well, we mentioned this matchup, Ashley Forrest and Ron Capps. Just 2 weeks, and we're going to be at it again, this time in Richmond, Virginia, for the Torco Racing Fuels Nationals qualifying on Saturday, the 6th of October. It's the countdown, the end of the countdown. Pro Stock Motorcycle, well, they end it today, and the rest of the pros in 2 weeks will know who goes on to the championship.
Well, this is a big matchup here, and I want to add on to what Tony Pedregon said. He said the air conditions aren't much different. That's because even though the temperature's down, the moisture in the air, those water drains are up. So that makes the air about the same as what they were seeing when it was hotter and a little bit drier. But the key is the track temperature being down. That's why we saw in Funny Car, our top fuel, we saw some very good runs, including low ET of the meet by Brandon Bernstein with that 4:53 elapsed time. Looks like both lanes are pretty even because Brandon ran that in the right lane. Everybody with lane choice so far has been choosing that left-hand lane. Don't think there's anything wrong with that one either. So this is good, should be a good race right here. Ron Capps, you know, I mean, he wants to get this win. He needs to kind of get this car back on track, even though, he hasn't had the race car he had at the beginning of the season, and he really needs to try to make a statement here this weekend.
Oh, look at that!
All right, good job.
Ashley Forrest, a 478.
478.
thousandths of a second. Ashley Force does it. Stuck that thing right down the middle of the lane. Taking that look at it, Ron Capps going to get about 200ths of a second advantage off the starting line. Obviously, that wasn't enough when your competition in the other lane is running low ET of the meet and puts Ron Capps on the trailer and helps her dad out big time right there.
You know, this track has not been all that good to Ron Capps, the all-concrete drag strip. Never been to a final at this race, and now Ashley Force scores a big win over him. And Capps being in the countdown fight, that's one less player. Robert Height is already out of competition, so some changes definitely will occur. Back up at the line, there's Jim Head coming off of a huge DNQ at Memphis. And alongside, it'll be Dell Worsham, runner-up at St. Louis and Sonoma this year. Can you imagine how Ron Capps feels?
I've been there. I know how he feels. It's tough, you know. I mean, Ron Capps just so many years finishing number two in the points, and this was a good shot for him to win the championship, but boy, they're really struggling. But right here, this man here, Dell Worsham, his father, Chuck, they've got a race car since just before Indy. I mean, this car's really turned around, been making some good numbers, hasn't been hurting itself like it was in the beginning of the season, so he must be happy about that.
And Jim Head, 114 back in the countdown. He's looking for a miracle. And he doesn't find it as our second member of the countdown gets eliminated here in first round. Dell Worsham takes that win and does so handily on the merits of a 483. When we come back, we'll be talking with Ron Capps. You see how dejected he is. It has not been a good string of races for Ron Capps.
An all-new contest.
Hot Rod Fuller putting the fuel in for the next round of eliminations, where he faced Larry Dixon. They get all the equipment ready and surely taking a really hard look at those rear tires. You saw what they looked like when he came off of the run. Back at the line, Tommy Johnson Jr. and Jeff Arend. Let's go to Gary Gerald. He has Ron Capps finally.
Ron, can you put any kind of a positive spin on this situation?
At the moment, probably not. Well, there's one more race, I guess, if that's positive. We were relaxed, had Pennywise on the radio, just all the stuff we normally do. We really try to come in here without concentrating on the points. Ace is, he's frustrated a little bit, and he's just kind of trying to find out what this car likes, and you have to get after him in the middle, and he's trying to sneak up on him without smoking the tires. He hates to do that, but for Napa Auto Parts and Brute, and all, you know, the Brigade people were here, and they did a big thing Friday night, and I want to thank them and the track for that, but we just got to go to Richmond now, and you hate to be a points watcher and then not cheer for a teammate or cheer for a teammate, but it's going to come down to hoping that somebody goes out, and I hate to do that to somebody, but you know what? Got to go to Richmond, win the race, and we'll be happy.
Thanks, Sean.
Well, it was Tommy Johnson Jr. ready for that one. An enormous hole shot. Tommy Johnson takes the win over Jeff Arend.
Yeah, if you take a look at it, TJ went in so deep, he almost put the top light out, so that's going to help your reaction time. An 065 light, he was almost a tenth of a second off the line against Jeff Arend. Probably threw Jeff off a little bit, but doesn't matter. The win light goes to TJ.
So Tommy Johnson Jr. advances. Of course, that matchup had no implication within the countdown because neither Arend or TJ were in the countdown fight.
Atta, baby.
Funny car points, Robert Height, a DNQ, but he remains number one, 57 points ahead of Gary Selzy. Jack Beckman is fairly safe. Capps, Selzy, Pedregon, Ashley Force, they are all still very much in the game.
Yes, they are. Right now on the starting line, you've got John Force, the big matchup. going against Tony Bartone. Now, John really needs this win, obviously, as he said in his interview. Good news is he saw his daughter run low ET of the meet in that lane. He has lane choice, so he's picking that left-hand lane, as pretty much everybody does. But, you know, this year we haven't seen that play out for him every race. You know, we've seen some of his teammates go out there make a good run, and he has still struggled. I think they have a little bit better handle on the car than they did at the beginning of the season. Still, he's going to have to be careful here.
John Force has 6 wins here in Texas, but he doesn't have a team car to help him on this side of the ladder. Tony Bartone won here, top alcohol funny car in 96.
But he does have a crew chief that says conditions are very similar to Friday night, so they're going to try to go out and duplicate their 480 numbers, take care of business. John was sitting in his race car when Ashley went down the racetrack and let out a big scream. Love you, Guido. Way to go, kid. Nobody heard that. John Force gave me a big thumbs up, and he went right back into the zone, trying to get back into this countdown to the championship.
I have a little staging duel here in funny car. John finally goes in.
Boy, he's out for a second there, and Bartone drifted over toward the line. John Force runs a 483-320, and John Force moves ahead.
John Force and the team did exactly what they needed to do to get that win. Just go down the racetrack, take another look at it. Bartone took his time, didn't want to go in first because John has a tendency to take his time. He forced his hand, made John go in, but it paid off better for John. He got the advantage off the starting line, and then Tony Bartone gets close to that center line, and as a result of that, John Force is going into the next round.
You know, when I saw Force on Friday, I said, how are things going? He says, I got to tell you, bad. They're bad. I got to go. Let's go to Dave Reif. He has Jack Beckman, another key player in this game.
Happy anniversary, Jack Beckman, cancer-free. We know that after the health scares, but the big concern right now is Tony Pedregon in this countdown. How do you keep the momentum going?
They're all big rounds now, but now you start looking at blocking and points, and when you race another countdown car, it's a double big move. You're always trying to build round points, but you want to prevent them from doing it. We got a great opportunity to help out all 3 Don Schumacher cars right now, but really it's business as usual. We're racing the racetrack. What Phil and Todd put in that MTS Valvoline car, we hope we just thunder and our wind light comes on.
At least he's not overthinking it.
And at the top end with John Force. And John, you're taking care of business with an 83, but how about your daughter Ashley knocking out Ron Capps? Your thoughts about that?
You know, I've been whining for years over these little girls, but now you know why God gives you little girls, so they can come up and do some damage. When old daddy gets old, he needs to get in this chase and this countdown, and she knows it. And Robert wasn't here in the AAA car to hurt us today, but if the big dogs fall out here, we can all come out of here good. We'll just see what happens. But I was really proud of her, because when Ashley's down, when she needs to do her job, that's when that kid performs. That's a little bit of me that she's got. Thank you.
Well, here's a rematch of the Norwalk race, which was won by Mike Ashley. There's Kenny Bernstein. And Mike Ashley's coming off that enormous DNQ at Memphis after winning at Indy. And due to religious beliefs, yesterday Ashley did not come to the track to qualify because he was recognizing the holiday of Yom Kippur. Now he is back in the contact. Well, 2 times this season he's DNQ'd and then won the next race. So where are we going with this?
Well, that looks good too, and the fact is the conditions have kind of played into his favor. The conditions are very similar to what we saw on Friday night. That is key, because he did not run yesterday. It was very hot. So they can take that information on that Friday night run. They're not going to be probably any more off than what Kenny Bernstein would be having all 4 runs, because they both ran in that session and ran decent.
You can see the tracks. He came way over to the line. Kenny Bernstein runs a 488 with an 8. What's going on the line?
Hey, guys in the booth, we're looking for some rain here. Absolutely, Rick's got it.
Oh, man, Rick Stewart, he's looking down at the track right at the conclusion of that run. And thanks a lot, Nellie. We appreciate it. Our cameraman on the line right there. They can get on top of everything immediately.
Yeah, and normally the first guys that know that are the guys in these cars, because you see the drops on the windshield, always a telltale sign. But Kenny Bernstein got the advantage off the starting line right side of your screen. And then when Mike Ashley, Brian Crotty tried to apply that clutch, Mike was in the middle of the lane. They just flat overpowered that lane, and we've seen some good runs out of there. But that unfortunately allowed Kenny Bernstein to get the win.
So we're not to the end of first round, and already Robert Height, Jim Head, Mike Ashley are out of the game. They're in the countdown, but they're done with competition. So that Bernstein win, that's going to be a big, big help, I think, for John Forrest as the day moves on. Back in the picks, well, Larry Dixon's team, they're working on the car. And they face Rod Fuller when they come back out. And it looks pretty quiet back there. Looks fairly routine, Mike.
Yep, normal maintenance, just pulling the rods and pistons out. They'll put eight fresh ones in there and put another clutch in it. And they'll be up ready for the next round. They've had a very good, consistent race car all year. But that's going to be a good race in the second round.
Well, when we come back, look at the matchup we have. We're hoping this is just a light shower, and it seems to be. It'll be Beckman and Pedregon. Big implications in the countdown. And that pair will be right on the line when we return. As fast as it came, the rain has gone away. We're ready to continue. Funny car, that big matchup that we've been talking about. There's Fast Jack Beckman. And Tony Pedregon. Beckman, new livery on the car. This is critical because they're both in the countdown. Jack Beckman moved from fifth to second in the points coming here. Tony Pedregon is just outside of the countdown. And let's take a look at our Fram specs. You'll see how Jack Beckman has moved since last year.
Yeah, since his debut here last year, average qualifying position just over six, three wins in five finals, and a 30-19 round record. Also holds the national speed record at over 333 miles per hour. Fast Jack. Jack has been good.
And if he can, in fact, win this, he has a chance to move to number one in funny car points. Phil Schuler, the chief on that car, they've been doing a great job on the team.
Oh, yes, they have. And we talk about the pressure, a little bit of a rain delay, so these drivers had to sit and think about it just a little bit more for a few more minutes. It's, I never like doing that myself as a driver. Just it seems like it adds to it, but you know, you end up normally thinking about it more when you're just waiting for the engine to start. And if, you know, if you're a championship driver like Tony Pedregon or a great driver like Jack Beckman, who's, you know, who's won the world championship in Supercomp, I mean, they know once the engine starts, you just focus on doing your job and let the numbers play out.
And Jack Beckman, driving for Don Schumacher, goes out in round one again with implications in the countdown. Hurts Beckman, may hurt him bad, and really helps Tony Pedregon.
And that is a big surprise, because Jack Beckman had a great race car all week and went down the racetrack on all four of his qualifying runs, and all four were quicker than Tony Pedregon's run. You see Tony, he was hurting that engine early in that particular pass, and that actually helped push the car towards the center. But Jack Beckman, he had worse problems, not in the engine department, basically in the clutch application to that horsepower, where it just went out there in the middle of the racetrack and spun the tires hard. Jack gets out of it, tries to get to recover, but it spins again, and that allows Tony Pedregon to get the win.
So how much did that help Tony Pedregon? From fifth up to third in the points, and 11 points ahead of Ron Capps. Robert Height remains 55 ahead of Ron Capps. Let's go to Gary.
Wow, we're looking at those points change in front of our eyes here, T-Ped. Now, not only in the top four, but up to the third spot. But this is going to be crazy going right to Richmond, isn't it?
It is. So we know it's going to go down to the last race. So what we're really trying to do is, not, you know, we want to get past the first round, but we've done that. We've achieved that big win for Q and horsepower. Put a cylinder out, Toyota, Snap-on, Tolles, Miner, Herzog, and we want to try to build a cushion now that we've gotten past that round. But there's no question, we got to hit our licks here, and there's one more to go after this, so we're not going to look. We've got to focus on this race this weekend.
All right, thanks, D-Pad. Let's go to Dave Rafe. He's got the young lady who's been fastest in this session thus far.
After a big win over Ron Capps, your dad said at the far end of the racetrack, that's a little bit of him starting to come out in you. Do you feel that coming out too?
Definitely. Dad, you know, one of Dad's biggest competitors all these years that I've been watching was Cap. So to be able to take him out, especially for Robert and Dad for the points, that's a big deal. It just makes everything that much more meaningful when you can take him out.
You nervous for those races?
Of course. But you got to not show it, right?
Easier said than done.
Well, at least he's being real honest about that one. There is Gary Selzy. Cruz Pedregon is alongside, and the winner here will face the number one qualifier, Tim Wilkerson.
This is a good matchup. I mean, Gary Selzy, you know, didn't qualify in the top half. He, as a result, he doesn't have lane choices. You look at crew chief Todd O'Kahara, Ron Tolbert with Cruz Pedregon. Cruz had a very good race car in the heat. Cooler conditions right now. Ron still learned how to run that funny car. He's going to hope right now he hits a combination and is going to be able to take out Gary Selzy, but Gary will have something to say about that. Wow.
Goodbye. Cruz Pedregon, and another one of those in the countdown goes down. Wow.
How about that cruiser? I mean, Todd O'Kahara's looking out there trying to figure out why that thing spun the tires. Lane choice might have hurt him, maybe that right lane, even though we saw some very good runs out of it in top fuel. As it goes along, it may not be just, track may not be as tight as it was earlier. Things change constantly, but man, how about Cruz and Ron Tolbert? That was a very nice pass.
Oh, and think of what we have seen thus far as we show you the Lucas Oil funny car ladder as Cruz Pedregon climbs out. There are only two that came here in the countdown left in competition as we go just the second round. Capps, Hyde, Head, Ashley, they are all out of competition.
How about that? That's what NHRA Power 8 Drag Racing is all about. You never know what's going to happen on race days. You look at the matchups in round two, the other side of the ladder, TJ and Tony Pedregon going head-to-head. And how about that matchup between the big names, John Force and Kenny Bernstein? John Force will have lane choice.
And speaking of some of the things that we have seen today, well, Tony Schumacher went up against Hot Rod Fuller. And Hot Rod had all the cards and took over number one in the points. So our Nitro rounds now complete. Here comes Pro Stock. Larry Morgan is trying to scare Jack Coughlin because that's who he comes up against. And once again, with points implications, big matchup. As many of you may know, but some may not, this is a tape-delayed recorded program. We tell you that because during the second round of Funny Car, there was an accident involving Kenny Bernstein and John Force. Kenny Bernstein is okay. John Force suffered broken legs, injury to his arm, possible concussion, and was evacuated to Baylor. Hot Rod Fuller putting the fuel in for the next round of eliminations, where he faced Larry Dixon. They get all the equipment ready, and surely taking a really hard look at those rear tires. You saw what they looked like when he came off of the run. Back at the line, Tommy Johnson Jr. and Jeff Arend. Let's go to Gary Gerald. He has Ron Capps finally.
Ron, can you put any kind of a positive spin on this situation?
At the moment, probably not. Well, there's one more race, I guess, if that's positive. We were relaxed, had Pennywise on the radio, just all the stuff we normally do. We really try to come in here without concentrating on the points. Ace is, he's frustrated a little bit, and he's just kind of trying to find out what this car likes, and you have to get after him in the middle, and he's trying to sneak up on him without smoking the tires. He hates to do that, but for Napa Auto Parts and Brute, and all, you know, the Brigade people were here, and they did a big thing Friday night, and I want to thank them and the track for that, but we just got to go to Richmond now, and you hate to be a points watcher, but and then not cheer for a teammate or cheer for a teammate, but it's going to come down to hoping that somebody goes out, and I hate to do that to somebody, but you know what? Got to go to Richmond, win the race, and we'll be happy.
Thanks, Sean.
Well, it was Tommy Johnson Jr. ready for that one. An enormous hole shot. Tommy Johnson takes the win over Jeff Arend.
Yeah, if you take a look at it, TJ went in so deep, he almost put the top light out, so that's going to help your reaction time. An 065 light, he was almost a tenth of a second off the line against Jeff Arend. Probably threw Jeff off a little bit, but doesn't matter. The win light goes to TJ.
So Tommy Johnson Jr. advances. Of course, that matchup had no implication within the countdown because neither Arend or TJ were in the countdown fight.
Atta, baby. Castrol across the front.
Funny car points, Robert Height, a DNQ, but he remains number one, 57 points ahead of Gary Selzy. Jack Beckman is fairly safe. Caps, Selzy, Pedregon, Ashley Force, they are all still very much in the game.
Yes, they are. Right now on the starting line, you've got John Force, the big matchup, going against Tony Bartone. Now, John really needs this win, obviously, as he said in his interview. Good news is he saw his daughter run low ET of the meet in that lane. He has lane choice, so he's picking that left-hand lane, as pretty much everybody does. But, you know, this year, we haven't seen that play out for him every race. You know, we've seen some of his teammates go out there make a good run, and he has still struggled. I think they have a little bit better handle on the car than they did at the beginning of the season. Still, he's going to have to be careful here.
John Force has 6 wins here in Texas, but he doesn't have a team car to help him on this side of the ladder. Tony Bartone won here, top alcohol funny car in 96.
But he does have a crew chief that says conditions are very similar to Friday night, so they're going to try to go out and duplicate their 480 numbers, take care of business. John was sitting in his race car when Ashley went down the racetrack and let out a big scream. Love you, Guido. Way to go, kid. Nobody heard that. John Force gave you a big thumbs up, and he went right back into the zone, trying to get back into this countdown to the championship.
I have a little staging duel here in funny car. John finally goes in.
Boy, he stopped for a second there, and Bartone drifted over toward the line. John Force runs a 483-320, and John Force moves ahead.
John Force and the team did exactly what they needed to do to get that win. Just go down the racetrack, take another look at it. Bartone took his time, didn't want to go in first because John has a tendency to take his time. He forced his hand, made John go in, but it paid off better for John. He got the advantage off the starting line, and then Tony Bartone gets close to that center line, and as a result of that, John Force is going into the next round.
You know, when I saw Force on Friday, I said, how are things going? He says, I got to tell you, bad. They're bad. I got to go. Let's go to Dave Reif. He has Jack Beckman, another key player in this game.
Happy anniversary, Jack Beckman, cancer-free. We know that after the health scares, but the big concern right now is Tony Pedregon in this countdown. How do you keep the momentum going?
They're all big rounds now, but now you start looking at blocking and points, and when you race another countdown car, it's a double big move. You're always trying to build round points, but you want to prevent them from doing it. We got a great opportunity to help out all 3 Don Schumacher cars right now, but really it's business as usual. We're racing the racetrack. What Phil and Todd put in that MTS Valvoline car, we hope we just thunder and our wind light comes on.
At least he's not overthinking it.
And at the top end with John Force. And John, you're taking care of business with an 83, but how about your daughter Ashley knocking out Ron Capps? Your thoughts about that?
You know, I've been whining for years over these little girls, but now you know why God gives you little girls, so they can come up and do some damage. When old daddy gets old, he needs to get in this chase and this countdown, and she knows it. Robert wasn't here in the AAA car to hurt us today, but if the big dogs fall out here, we can all come out of here good. We'll just see what happens. But I was really proud of her, because when Ashley's down, when she needs to do her job, that's when that kid performs. That's a little bit of me that she's got. Thank you.
Well, here's a rematch of the Norwalk race, which was won by Mike Ashley. There's Kenny Bernstein. And Mike Ashley's coming off that enormous DNQ at Memphis after winning at Indy. And due to religious beliefs, yesterday Ashley did not come to the track to qualify, because he was recognizing the holiday of Yom Kippur. Now he is back in the contact. Well, 2 times this season he's DNQ'd and then won the next race. So where are we going with this?
Well, that looks good too. And the fact is, the conditions have kind of played into his favor. The conditions are very similar to what we saw on Friday night. That is key, because he did not run yesterday. It was very hot. So they can take that information on that Friday night run. They're not going to be probably any more off than what Kenny Bernstein would be having all 4 runs, because they both ran in that session and ran decent. Oh.
Uh-oh for Mike Ashley. And you can see the tracks. He came way over to the line. Kenny Bernstein runs a 4.88 with an 8. What's going on the line?
Hey, guys in the booth, we're looking for some rain here. Absolutely, Rick's got it.
Oh, man, Rick Stewart, he's looking down at the track right at the conclusion of that run. And thanks a lot, Nellie. We appreciate it. Our cameraman on the line right there. They can get on top of everything immediately.
Yeah, and normally the first guys that know that are the guys in these cars, because you see the drops on the windshield, always a telltale sign. But Kenny Bernstein got the advantage off the starting line right side of your screen. And then when Mike Ashley, Brian Crotty tried to apply that clutch, Mike was in the middle of the lane. They just flat overpowered that lane, and we've seen some good runs out of there. But that unfortunately allowed Kenny Bernstein to get the win.
So we're not to the end of first round, and already Robert Height, Jim Head, Mike Ashley are out of the game. They're in the countdown, but they're done with competition. So that Bernstein win, that's going to be a big, big help, I think, for John Forrest as the day moves on. Back in the picks, well, Larry Dixon's team, they're working on the car. And they face Rod Fuller when they come back out. And it looks pretty quiet back there. Looks fairly routine, Mike.
Yep, normal maintenance, just pulling the rods and pistons out. They'll put 8 fresh ones in there and put another clutch in it. And they'll be up ready for the next round. They've had a very good, consistent race car all year. But that's going to be a good race in the second round.
Well, when we come back, look at the matchup we have. We're hoping this is just a light shower, and it seems to be. It'll be Beckman and Pedregon. Big implications in the countdown. And that pair will be right on the line when we return. As fast as it came, the rain has gone away. We're ready to continue. Funny car, that big matchup that we've been talking about. There's Fast Jack Beckman. And Tony Pedregon. Beckman, new livery on the car. This is critical because they're both in the countdown. Jack Beckman moved from 5th to 2nd in the points coming here. Tony Pedregon is just outside of the countdown. And let's take a look at our Fram specs. You'll see how Jack Beckman has moved since last year.
Yeah, since his debut here last year, average qualifying position just over 6. 3 wins in 5 finals and a 30-19 round record. Also holds the national speed record at over 333 miles per hour. Fast Jack. Jack has been good.
And if he can, in fact, win this, he has a chance to move to number 1 in funny car points. Phil Schuler, the chief on that car, they've been doing a great job on the team.
Oh, yes, they have. And we talk about the pressure, a little bit of a rain delay, so these drivers had to sit and think about it just a little bit more for a few more minutes. That's, I never like doing that myself as a driver. Just it seems like it adds to it, but you know, you end up normally thinking about it more when you're just waiting for the engine to start. And if, you know, if you're a championship driver like Tony Pedregon or a great driver like Jack Beckman, who's, you know, who's won the world championship in Supercomp, I mean, they know once the engine starts, you just focus on doing your job and let the numbers play out.
A 504-277, and Jack Beckman, driving for Don Schumacher, goes out in round 1 again with implications in the countdown. Hurts Beckman, may hurt him bad, and really helps Tony Pedregon.
And that is a big surprise, because Jack Beckman had a great race car all week and went down the racetrack on all 4 of his qualifying runs, and all 4 were quicker than Tony Pedregon's run. You see Tony, he was hurting that engine early in that particular pass, and that actually helped push the car towards the center. But Jack Beckman, he had worse problems, not in the engine department, basically in the clutch application to that horsepower, where it just went out there in the middle of the racetrack and spun the tires hard. Jack gets out of it, tries to get to recover, but it spins again, and that allows Tony Pedregon to get the win.
So how much did that help Tony Pedregon? From 5th up to 3rd in the points, and 11 points ahead of Ron Capps. Robert Height remains 55 ahead of Ron Capps. Let's go to Gary.
Wow, we're looking at those points change in front of our eyes here, T-Ped. Now, not only in the top 4, but up to the 3rd spot. But this is going to be crazy going right to Richmond, isn't it?
It is. So we know it's going to go down to the last race. So what we're really trying to do is not, you know, we want to get past the first round, but we've done that. We've achieved that big win for Q and horsepower. Put a cylinder out, Toyota, Snap-on, Tools, Miner, Herzog, and we want to try to build a cushion now that we've gotten past that round. But there's no question, we got to hit our licks here, and there's one more to go after this, so we're not going to look. We've got to focus on this race this weekend.
All right, thanks, D-Pad. Let's go to Dave Reif. He's got the young lady who's been fastest in this session thus far.
Your big win over Ron Capps, your dad said at the far end of the racetrack, that's a little bit of him starting to come out in you. Do you feel that coming out too?
Definitely. Dad, you know, one of Dad's biggest competitors all these years that I've been watching was Cap. So to be able to take him out, especially for Robert and Dad for the points, that's a big deal. It just makes everything that much more meaningful when you can take him out.
You nervous for those races?
Of course, but you got to not show it, right?
Easier said than done.
Well, at least he's being real honest about that one. There is Gary Selzy. Cruz Pedregon is alongside, and the winner here will face the number one qualifier, Tim Wilkerson.
This is a good matchup. I mean, Gary Selzy, you know, didn't qualify in the top half. He, as a result, he doesn't have lane choices. You look at crew chief Todd O'Kahara, Ron Tolbert with Cruz Pedregon. Cruz had a very good race car in the heat. Cooler conditions right now. Ron still learned how to run that funny car. He's going to hope right now he hits the combination and is going to be able to take out Gary Selzy, but Gary will have something to say about that. Wow.
Goodbye. Cruz Pedregon, and another one of those in the countdown goes down. Wow.
How about that cruiser? I mean, Todd O'Kahara's looking out there trying to figure out why that thing spun the tires. Lane choice might have hurt him, maybe that right lane, even though we saw some very good runs out of it in top fuel. As it goes along, it may not be just, track may not be as tight as it was earlier. Things change constantly, but man, how about Cruz and Ron Tobler? That was a very nice pass.
Boy, and think of what we have seen thus far as we show you the Lucas Oil funny car ladder as Cruz Pedregon climbs out. There are only two that came here in the countdown left in competition as we go just the second round. Caps, Hyde, Head, Ashley, they are all out of competition.
How about that? That's what NHRA Power 8 Drag Racing is all about. You never know what's going to happen on race days. You look at the matchups in round two, the other side of the ladder, TJ and Tony Pedregon going head-to-head. And how about that matchup between the big names, John Force and Kenny Bernstein? John Force will have lane choice.
And speaking of some of the things that we have seen today, well, Tony Schumacher went up against Hot Rod Fuller, and Hot Rod had all the cards and took over number one in the points. So our Nitro rounds now complete. Here comes Pro Stock. Larry Morgan just trying to scare Jack Coughlin because that's who he comes up against. And once again, with points implications, big matchup. As many of you may know, but some may not, this is a tape-delayed recorded program. We tell you that because during the second round of Funny Car, there was an accident involving Kenny Bernstein and John Force. Kenny Bernstein is okay. John Force suffered broken legs, injury to his arm, possible concussion, and was evacuated to Baylor. We'll have more on that, and you will see that accident coming up in about 45 minutes. Now, back to our tape-delayed programming.
Here we go.
Dallas, we're on the south side, the Texas Motorplex, the magnificent all-concrete drag strip, great facilities, beautiful grandstands, big crowd, and we're ready for Pro Stock as we look at the Lucas Oil Pro Stock ladder, and the very first pair is enormous. Both of them are fighting in the countdown, Larry Morgan and Jake Coughlin.
And on the other side of the ladder, we don't have any drivers in the countdown going to head-to-head, but that Richie Stevens WJ matchup's always fun to watch.
And where they stand at this moment.
Jed Coughlin there in third place. Alan Johnson that fourth and final spot. Bert Johnson just 5 points out of there. And Larry Morgan, 36, just a little more than actually 3 rounds out.
Yeah, and Larry Morgan really needs a win here if he wants to keep the countdown hopes alive.
There he had lane choices, taking that right-hand lane. All the fuel cars chose the left-hand lane and had lane choice.
Exactly what was required.
Wow. You know, I know Larry Morgan out-qualified Jag, but it's still a mild upset there because, but Larry Morgan did a great job. Go on board with Jaggy. Larry was 300s of advantage off the starting line, and then you see Jag just move way over towards the center line. At that point, he knew he had to shut off, and all he could do was watch Larry get into the next round.
And so back at the line, here is Ron Krischer and Jason Line. We go to Gary Gerald.
Larry Morgan, how big, in your estimation, is that victory right there over Jake Coughlin?
You know, they're all big, especially when he's ahead of me in points. You know, that's all we're here for, is to try and get in that top four before the four Vegas. And, you know, this is one step ahead. So, hey, we're just happy to get this Lucas Oil car into the next round, as tough as it is out here. There'll be a lot of good racing today, and I can't wait to. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ron Krischer, he's got Cagnazzi Power on board, still builds a lot of engines of his own, and he's pretty happy with how they're working, even more happy with how that Cagnazzi motor is working for him. He has only two round wins, though, in all of his trips to Dallas. Jason Line, 34 points out of fourth when he got here. And he's all over the place. But still, that's a win for Line with a 671, 206. Wasn't all that pretty, but he got there.
Yeah, and it was a whole shot win. Jason really did his job on the starting line, something he's been struggling with, but he nailed it that time, and it was a good thing because this 671, slower than Ron Krischer's 669, but the difference was on the starting line. Even though you saw Jason get a little sideways off the starting line, he reeled it back in and gets it into the second round.
And as we look back up to the starting line, Justin Humphreys and Kurt Johnson. And we should tell you, with that run, Dave Conley has clinched number one because Jag lost it. So we have Andrew Hines and Dave Conley have both clinched number one in the countdown. Dave Reif.
Down in the pits with Mike Ashley, who would have loved to have heard the words "Whoa, Nelly" a little bit earlier. Those raindrops that did stop us down for a little bit, maybe cost you?
Oh, there's no doubt about it. I mean, you know, I took the day off yesterday. It was a good idea because we field stripped the entire car, found what the problem is with the car. We were on a perfect run. It was going to go a 77 or 78. It was overlaid, and it just drove right into the water and drove right into smoke.
In fact, your guys were going down the return road. They even knew it ahead of time.
Yeah, they at the half track, they had the windshield wipers on. So, I mean, you know, it's just it's an unfortunate thing. Unfortunately, they sent us down the track, and for Torco Ridge Fuels, they feel terrible. But we're still in this hunt with the way the points worked out. And when we go to Richmond, you know, we're going to be swinging for the fences, bottom line.
For KJ, this one is critical. Let's go to the line.
We got a sneaky duel. Rick is going to sit it out. He is not pleased at all.
So a little staging battle between Justin and KJ. KJ needs to win rounds. He won here 93, 95, and 2000. They still sit on the line, Mike Dunn.
See Rick Stewart checking his watch. We're already 40 seconds into this. Neither driver wants to go in there. This will be interesting to see what happens here. See Jason and Morgan watching down there. There's Bob Glidden, Justin Humphrey's crew chief. I'm sure he's instructed him what to do. If Jason maybe went and asked him if it would be okay. Evidently, they said, go for it. See what happens.
Oh, look at that red light. Come on for KJ. He did not need that.
Wow, his third red light of the season. Man, you are right. He did not need that. Throws it away, a 670 lap time. Justin Humphreys goes in the next round with a 672 at 205 miles per hour.
So already in pro stock, Jag Coughlin and KJ are out, both contenders in the countdown. Costly to both of them. Well, let's go to John Kernan. He's with Larry Dixon, who could make a big move in the points.
Absolutely right, Paul. We're down in the pits, and Larry, you take on Hot Rod Fuller in the next round. If you beat him, I believe you get the points lead. Are you thinking that far ahead? Because last week you told me you were looking over your shoulder, not ahead.
I'm still looking that way. You know, the way the points are, I mean, it can flip-flop so much. I'm definitely still looking at fifth place. You know, Vandegrift's... If he's not there, he could be there. So you just want to be able to be in the top four at this point. And, you know, if we win the rounds, you know, we shouldn't have to worry about it.
Well, they looked okay, pretty good with a 454 in the first round. And Donnie Bender says they might have some more out there in this next round of eliminations.
Yeah, for Larry Dixon, first time he's been looking at the top of the points since back in 03. There's Jim Yates, who clinched his championship in 96 here in the other lane. No, Alan Johnson in the countdown, just the slimmest of margins there. Only one round win in the countdown.
Well, this is a big run for Alan Johnson. His dad, Roy Johnson, making the big horsepower, but he's got to get around Jim Yates. Jim Yates, obviously, he knows the pressure of running for a championship. As you look at his engine builder, Bill Grumpy Jenkins, looking on over there. Jim knows how to race these cars. He says he wants to be the spoiler. He's relishing it in the fact that he can take out some of these big names. But, you know, Alan Johnson is going to be a tough one. We'll see how it works out.
And we saw a little moisture there. Alan Johnson comes off the line first, runs a 671, 205, and takes the win over Jim Yates.
Boy, Jim Yates gave him a race. They both pretty much ran almost the identical ETs, but the difference was off the starting lines. You see our Lucas Oil photo finish, just a little bit less than half a car length. Alan Johnson gets the win.
Well, there's Greg Anderson, who has clinched his position in the countdown and continues his powerful year. And we'll show you the ladder. It'll be Greg Anderson taking on another contender in the countdown, Larry Morgan, when they come back for the second round.
Well, then on the other side of the ladder, you got countdown contender Dave Conley going up against Max Naylor. And then Richie Stevens going up against Jason Lyon, with Richie having lane choice.
Yeah, what about Clay Milliken? He can ruin some people's day. When we come back in Top Fuel, he'll face Brandon Bernstein. Bernstein is in the countdown, Milliken is not.
ESPN's presentation of the O'Reilly NHRA Fall Nationals, brought to you by Powerade. Sport is what you make it. And by Subway Restaurants. Subway, eat fresh.
Part of the beautiful skyline of downtown Dallas, the Fountain Place Building, and we are just south of the downtown at the Texas Motorplex for NHRA drag racing. And we start by sending you down to the far end to Gary Gerald.
Well, Kurt, we end up watching a staging duel there that went almost 1 minute. How did that cost you?
Well, that was kind of fun, actually. You know, it's good for the fans, but it wasn't good for the AC Delco car. We've had trouble with the lights with 70s and 80s, and, you know, we had to raise the chip to get off the starting line to get the reaction better, and actually the car made a good run. The clutch may have got a little hot, 013, you know, you just can't measure that. And, you know, I don't know what it is about Justin. We're 006 negative the last time we ran him. You know, he's a good driver, he's up and coming, but, you know, we know we're as good as anybody else out here, and just a bad day for the AC Delco car. But we got one more race going into Richmond. We're going to try and get that top four.
Thanks.
Yeah, but it just got made a little bit tougher. Here are the highlights from round one.
Yeah, first up, we're going to have B Gaines going up against red hot Max Naylor. B throws it away with a red light, handing Max Naylor the win. A free ride into the second round.
And then next up, Richie Stevens and Warren Johnson. Warren Johnson in the countdown, needs the win, but is not going to get it. Richie Stevens, a 669, 205, takes out Warren Johnson.
And next up, we got our points leader, Dave Conley, going up against that man, Craig Hankinson. Both drivers get off to the start. Craig actually got a little bit off first, but then gets very loose in the middle of the racetrack. And that allows Dave Conley to run a 667, 206 miles per hour to get him the win.
That brought up the number one qualifier, Greg Anderson and Kenny Koreski, the first time back at this track since his crash 2 years ago. This all the way, Greg Anderson. He's proven his power again, runs a 667, 206 miles an hour. So the Pro Stock ladder presented by Lucas Oil, and Larry Morgan, he's got it tough again as he'll have to face Greg Anderson in round two.
Larry Morgan's going to have to work today. On the other side of the ladder, we got some good matchup. Dave Conley going up against Max Naylor, and Richie Stevens will be going up against Jason Lyne.
And Dave Conley and Greg Anderson, they have both clinched in the countdown. We look at the rest of it then.
You look at that breakdown to get in that top four. Alan Johnson, Jed Coffin. Jed already out of it. Kurt Johnson out of it. Jason still moving on.
Looking ahead to Pro Stock Motorcycle, Dave Reif is with Angel Sampe.
Three-time champion Angel Sampe, if you want to have your shot at a fourth, you got to make up three rounds. How are you going to do that today?
You know, my friend Chip Ellis, he said he had the perfect quote on NHRA.com. He said, "I don't know anybody who's ever won a race without winning the first round." So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to go out there and I'm going to try to win the first round.
Luck to you.
That's what I'm going to do.
And of all the contenders in Pro Stock Motorcycle, Angel is the only one to face somebody else in the countdown. It will be Craig Treble when Angel comes to the line in Pro Stock round one. It has been a tumultuous couple of weeks for Angel Sampe. Two straight first-round losses have dropped her to fifth in the point standings. Along the way, she learned that her sponsor would not be back next season. Today is her last chance to overcome the distractions and a two-round deficit to make it into the top four or be left to ponder what might have been. So as Pro Stock Motorcycle begins, we look at the Lucas Oil Pro Stock Motorcycle ladder and the matchups upcoming. And again, the fight for Pro Stock Motorcycle ends right here at the end of the day in terms of the countdown.
And there's that must-win race for the countdown to the championship, or countdown to four, Angel and Craig Treble. Big matchup there.
Right now on the line, Michael Ray and Chip Ellis. Ray, his first race day start. Chip Ellis, been up and down that ladder, comes here fourth in the countdown, needs to make something happen.
Chip is your number one qualifier. Just need to stay focused, go green, not be too late.
Chip Ellis, 699, 190 miles an hour. Ray, a 727. Must be pretty intimidating going up against a guy like Ellis in your very first run. And back up at the line, Craig Treble and Angel Sampe. We mentioned how important that is, Mike Dunn, as we look at the standings.
You see Angel basically, you know, three rounds out of that final four spot. Craig Treble there. You know, this, like you said, I mean, this is a must-win for both of these riders right here. But you know, we talk about the pressure of it. Talked about on our show on NHRA Race Day this morning. And basically, from Craig Treble's standpoint, you know, he's playing on, you know, on house money, because he wasn't even close, and he barely gets in that eighth position, and then, you know, he goes out there and he wins the U.S. Nationals, has a good showing last week. So I mean, he basically just goes out there and has fun, which is what you really need to do as a driver. You know, try to put everything outside you and focus on doing your job. Angel, she's won championships. She knows how, but you know, the pressure's on her. You know, you have a big sponsor. You're expected to win. It really changes how it affects the riders, certain riders anyway, and we'll see what happens here.
Sampe, a 703-189 over Treble, 707.
Wow, that was a race there.
That was a great drag race.
Yeah, Craig Treble got the advantage off the starting line by 4.5 hundredths of a second. Man, I thought he was almost going to hang on, but Angel made a very good run in that right-hand lane, which he had for lane choice. And if you look at the Lucas Oil photo finish, that margin of victory, I mean, you pick him there. That was close.
And there you see it. Treble came off the line hot, and then Angel took over. That was terrific. There's Steve Johnson, and he'll go up against Peggy Llewellyn, who is in the countdown. There's Peggy. We go to the far end, Gary Gerald.
Craig Treble reviewing the numbers that he gets from Harry Lartigue, and when you lose by 12 ten-thousandths of a second, a matter of inches, and with what's at stake, how do you digest all of that, Craig?
I'm not
My chest isn't very good at all. You know, Gary, I went to a bracket race here a couple weeks ago down at Treeport, and margin of victory in the third round that I lost was 0017. Now this one's 0012. You know, it's drag racing, but darn it, man, we needed those points, and we'll see how it goes. You know, last year at World Finals, we bailed Andrew out, and he ended up being world champion. I'm hoping the little guy pays me back.
We'll find out.
Peggy Llewellyn, Steve Johnson. This is a real must-win day all the way through for Peggy Llewellyn.
Oh, Steve Johnson goes red by 1/1000th of a second.
Well, if it's a must-win day, that's one of the ways to do it. Peggy Llewellyn on the merits of Steve Johnson's red light. Runs through at a 7.0289 miles an hour and takes the win. Pro Stock Motorcycle point standings. Andrew Hines still the only one who has clinched, though Matt Smith is close behind, and Craig Treble could be in trouble.
Oh boy, definitely does. It's Craig Treble, that number four spot has already been taken out. Angel and Peggy Llewellyn, if they have to win the race, if either one of them can win the race, they would take out Craig Treble for that final position.
Let's go to the far end. Gary Gerald is with Peggy Llewellyn.
And Peggy is doing her best to keep those hopes alive. Basically, it boils down, you've got to win this race. How do you think your chances are?
Well, they're pretty good. I have my crew who won the Full Throttle Award, so they're getting this Rush Racing Products Bureau tuned up for me, so I can do that, and I'd like to do it for the home crowd.
Oh, it's very interesting. Good luck to you.
Thank you.
And here are the remainder of the highlights out of Pro Stock Motorcycle.
Let's get started out with Antron Brown against Eddie Krawick. Suzuki versus the Harley. Antron gets to jump off the starting line. But then it's Eddie Krawick on the other end. Gets the win with a 7.04. Takes out Antron 7.08.
And that brought up Gino Scali and Hector Arana. Arana's been having a really good set of runs lately. And on this one, he takes down the former Powerade champion as Hector Arana runs a 7.03 at 180 miles an hour to advance.
How about your points leader, Andrew Hines, left side of your screen, going up against Tom Bradford. Both bikes get the green light start. No big advance for either one, but look at that Harley just pull away for the other end with that horsepower. 7 flat at 191 miles per hour gets Andrew into the second round.
Matt Godera, who won at Maple Grove, and Karen Stoffer. Karen Stoffer is in the countdown. So important for her to come up with a win, and she does just exactly that. Running a 7.05 at 189 miles an hour.
Next up, it's Matt Smith up against Michael Phillips. We had a little bit of a staging duel here, well over a minute before the riders went in. And guess what? Matt Smith just pulls away from Michael, makes a nice pass, 7 flat, 190 miles per hour, gets him into the next round.
So as they go to second round in Pro Stock Motorcycle, look at this. With the exception of one pair, everybody figures solidly head-to-head in the countdown. Ellis, Krawick, Llewellyn, and Stoffer, they're in the countdown.
And how about the other ones on the other side of the ladder in the countdown? That monster matchup between Andrew Hines and Angel Sampe, and Matt Smith's going to race Hector Arana.
And Matt Smith, though, is in good shape. He has already clinched his spot along with Andrew Hines. 1 and 2 are now clinched. The focus really is what's going to happen with Craig Treble out. Well, round two is ready to come up, and Larry Dixon, he has an opportunity to move to number one in the points and top fuel. They're warming the engine up and getting ready to go as we get ready for top fuel to make their return. Don't go away.
An all-new contender.
For the crowd in the stands, slightly cloudy sky overhead, the O'Reilly Fall Nationals. I'm Paul Page with Mike Dunn, Dave Reif, Gary Gerald, John Kernan, and it's time now for our Ford feedback. And the question comes from James Williamson from Farmington, Michigan. What type of activities are available to keep people entertained when the cars are not racing on the drag strip? John Forrest has that answer.
And if the thrill of victory isn't enough, or just the thrill of side-by-side racing, nitromethane, funny cars, Mustangs, top fuel, pro stock, at their best,
at over 330 miles an hour, well, then you just got to take a walk to the pits and get the experience. Not just the great food, not just the great fans, but you got to go to the Midway. You can see Castrol's Museum. You can walk through it and see all about John Force. And if that ain't enough for you, go over to the Ford Racing Trailer. Unbelievable in the Midway, and you'll see racing at its best, because you can sit in a simulator and race your buddy side by side. It's a thrill. You can work at putting a motor together. You can get an education there as well as fun, and you can win things. So come and join us. Join the fans at the greatest show on earth, right?
Yeah! You're right about that, John Forrest. ESPN and Ford want to know what you want to know. Log on to www.fordracing.com and click on Feedback to submit your questions for next week's Ford Feedback. Our NASCAR coverage continues next week in Kansas City on both ESPN2 and on ABC. The track, which was completed in 2001, 1.5 miles around, a great facility, always produces great races. Now, it's time for our Valvoline Garage Tip. Here's John Kernan.
Hot Rod Fuller's crew continue to work on their cars. They get ready for the second round matchup against Larry Dixon with big points implications. Dixon also in that top four in the countdown. And while they work on the engine, I want to give you a closer look at something that Gary Gerald pointed out after the pass was made, and that was the chunking of the tires. These are both of the rear tires that came off of Hot Rod's car. You see the chunking there, but then look up here on the tread where it actually started ripping the tread off of the tires. I talked to his crew chief, Rob Flynn. He said that these tires were brand new. It was their first pass. He says the only problem was they had them hooked up too well to the racetrack, so it was actually gripping so much on the racetrack, it was starting to rip the tread off.
And think of the kind of energy that it would take to do that. Well, coming up, it'll be Larry Dixon and Rod Fuller as they go face to face to see who can come out of that confrontation number one in the points. A Maverick. Welcome back to Texas, the O'Reilly Fall Nationals. Top Fuel comes to the line again. And we will begin with Bob Vandergrift Jr. and Doug Coletta. And just a reminder, you love the motors? How about NASCAR? NASCAR coverage continues next weekend, Kansas City, on both ESPN2 and on ABC. NASCAR Busch Series at Kansas, presented by Principal Financial, Saturday afternoon on ESPN2. And we look at the ladder, presented by Lucas Oil, with Fuller and Dixon coming up, and whoever wins there ends up number one.
On the other side of the ladder, we got some other matchups too, including Corey McLennan going against Whit Bazemore. Whit having lane choice. And then the matchup on the starting line right now, Doug Coletta versus Bob Vandergrift. Bob with the lane choice and choosing that left-hand lane.
Doug Coletta is not in the countdown, but he's got some personal issues that he wants to settle. He thinks that things are getting much better for him, and they need to. He has not yet won this year. Bob Vandergrift, only one round win in the countdown until he came here today. He's trying to make something work for him.
This is an important round for Bob right now. He's sixth in the countdown point standing.
61 points behind fourth place for Vandergrift. And Coletta goes away, lights the tires. Bob Vandergrift of 464, 317 miles an hour. And he keeps his countdown hopes alive.
Tell you, Jim Dupuy and that team just doing a great job getting the car down the track. That's the main key there. Left side of your screen, Doug Coletta was a little bit ahead at 330-foot mark, but right at that point, it started spinning the tires. That allowed Bob Vandergrift, even with the cylinders out, to get the win with a 464 and into the semifinals. Watch right side of your screen. Bob was stuck right in the middle of that lane. Gets one cylinder out, just about 1,000-foot mark. The other one goes out right for the finish line, but he gets the win.
And, of course, we keep tracking the points. These are current, so Bob Vandergrift is now just 41 points behind Brandon Bernstein and fourth place, which is critical, not just today, but absolutely critical in 2 weeks at Richmond. Here's another guy that is trying to make something happen and having a lot of trouble doing it in the countdown. It is Whit Bazemore. He will go alongside and against Corey McLenathan.
Yeah, Corey Mack right here has got a good race car. But I'll tell you what, Whit Bazemore, I mean, they've got a long shot at getting in the countdown to four. They said we basically have to go out there and win the next two races. And I'll tell you what, this car's looked very good this weekend. They definitely look like they could win today. But here's second round, track conditions change. Let's see what happens.
A 4:59, 327 to a losing 4:57 for Corey Mack.
Wow, Bazemore did his job on that. Corey's a little bit late, a little bit of a surprise, having 1:38 reaction time. Whit had a little over 400 of a second advantage off the start, and obviously he needed it because he's running a 4:59 in that right-hand lane. Corey Mack on the other side is making a nice pass, runs a 4:57, but comes up short.
So that means that Whit Bazemore will face Bob Vandergrift when they go to the semifinals. We look at the Lucas Oil photo finish cam. Larry Dixon and Rod Fuller. This may be the biggest run we've seen today, and it's been a day with a lot of big runs. Winner here moves to number one.
How about Hot Rod Fuller? I mean, he's in control of his own destiny, having to take out Tony Schumacher in the first round. Now he's coming up against a red-hot Larry Dixon. This is a good matchup here, too. Probably the two most consistent cars race to race all year long. Haven't got a lot of the race wins that we see with Brandon Bernstein and Tony Schumacher, but they get the round win. So these cars are pretty evenly matched right now. You know, lane choice, left lane has been chosen by Larry Dixon. Donnie Bender likes what he sees out there, so he's in that lane. We saw Corey Mack just run a 4:57 in that lane, but we also saw 4:59 on the right, so both lanes look like they're pretty even for two consistent race cars.
So this is the fight for number one in the countdown as it stands right now. It's already changed twice today. Will it change yet again?
I like what Larry Dixon says. He said he's not even looking up to number one. He's looking behind him for that number four spot, because that's all he's really concerned with, is staying in that countdown to four.
Hot Rod smokes the tires. Dixon has the motor go, but he wins it. Dixon, a 4:67, 2:75 to a 5:42. David Power saying, what happened there?
Wow, just flat overpowered the racetrack for Hot Rod Fuller. Don the Snake Prudhomme likes what he sees with his driver. As far as the wind light, I'm sure he didn't like to see all that flame and smoke on the other end. On board with Hot Rod there. See it go into tire smoke, and then you see the fire erupt out of Larry Dixon's. But I guarantee you, he didn't see Hot Rod. He knew the thing was laying over. But, man, as you go on board, I'm legging it to the finish line because I'm into the next round.
Yeah, I imagine that Snake, who is pretty careful with his bucks, is saying that is a really expensive way to go to number one in the points. Let's go up to the far end, Gary Gerald.
Bob Vandergrift, for the first time since we got into this phase of the countdown, has won back-to-back rounds, oh so significant. How closely are you counting points in between these opportunities?
I can lie to you and say we're not. We're just trying to win rounds, but we're counting the points. We know where the UPS team's at and where we need to be at, and that was a big matchup, and we got another one coming ahead of us right now, so we know who's winning and who's losing and what we need to do, but if we take care of the semifinals and the finals, it's going to take care of it for us, too.
Bob goes against Bazemore in his next opportunity.
Well, and you can bet that he is going to be cheering for Clay Milliken as we look at Brandon Bernstein. Got a glimpse of Clay there moments ago. Brandon is in the countdown fight. Clay Milliken is not. So a win by Milliken could help Vandergrift a great deal.
Oh, and absolutely. Clay Milliken already took out one of the points contenders in J.R. Todd in the first round. And now he's going to try to take out Brandon Bernstein. But I tell you, Brandon's got a very good race car. The General likes this racetrack. He usually runs pretty well here. But Johnny West with Clay Milliken, he's been giving Clay a very consistent race car. That's got to be giving Clay some confidence.
Got tire smoke on both sides.
And it's Milliken!
everybody's looking down there saying, what was that? But boy, was it entertaining.
Man, those pedal fests always are, especially when they end up that close at the finish line. Take another look at it. You're going to see Clay Milliken, left side of your screen, is going to spin the tires first, and then Brandon's going to spin them. Well, not much after Clay did. Boy, they both got sideways. Clay, he drove that thing drifting across the finish line. Clay did. Wow, that was wild. The key was the 500th of a second advantage off of the starting line. Got a little bit close to the wall, too, there. Let's take a listen to this. This was down. And look at how
close
at the finish line. Look how close Clay was to the wall. And there it is. Look at the incremental times. You can see at the finish, it was Clay Milliken was able to drive around. They were going back and forth all the way down the track. Great race.
Yeah, and you know what that's going to do for us for the semifinals? Three of the four drivers in the semis have never won a top fuel race. We look at the matchup for the semifinals. Clay is going to see Larry Dixon when he comes up, and Bazemore and Vandergriff will go against one another. Gary Gerald's with Clay.
Wow, a lot of celebrating going on here. When you put a pedal fest and a whole shot win all together, second consecutive victory today. You talk us through this one.
Well, you know what, I tell you, I messed up badly, and I got to apologize to the team. I did not mean to turn the top light out. We got different brakes on the car, and I'm trying to learn it. And I thought the car was going to make it. It got a little out of control. Then Brandon's over here having trouble, obviously, and I give her a little breather. Then I stood on that bad boy. Evan tells me all the time, stand on that bad boy. I didn't think I was going to get there, but I did. You know what? We're going to the semis. How about this?
Yes, you are.
Rat and roll with Evan Noel, baby. That's what it's all about. Everybody in Michigan and Drummond's, we're having a good old time. And, you know, we ain't in that countdown, but we want to win us a race, and we might just do that right here in Texas right now today.
I'm fired up. I don't know about you guys in the booth. I want to find me a bad boy to stand on it.
Yeah, he just may be helping or hurting a lot of people in the countdown. The Lucas Oil Funny Car Ladder as they match up now. Coming into the second round, Tommy Johnson and Tony Pedregon are at the line right now.
Only two guys left in the countdown. That's Tony Pedregon going up against Tommy Johnson Jr. They're on the line right now. John Force is in that other matchup.
All right, Tony Pedregon just roared out of there. Takes the whole shot, takes the win, 499, 303 miles an hour.
Wow, another whole shot victory. Tony Pedregon this time does the number right behind Clay Milliken. Take another look at it. You're going to see basically, about a little over 500ths of a second advantage for Tony Pedregon on the left side of your screen. That was the difference. This was a pretty good old drag race. Cars were pretty much locked together side by side. Tommy Johnson ran a little bit quicker at the finish line, but that whole shot off of the start cost him the win.
Current standings in the points, and Tony Pedregon, just think about how he's been moving up through this day. Wow. Well, there is plenty more funny car coming forward. And of those who have moved forward in the points, one of them would be John Force. And now Tony Pedregon, and he moves on to the semis. Boy, we have seen some action today. Well, the Texas Motorplex has been giving this crowd some great action all throughout the day. Pro Stock Motorcycle, they're finishing up their countdown. And for the rest of the pros, it's one more race. That's in 2 weeks at Richmond. But where is it going now? There's Ashley Ford. She won here in Top Alcohol Dragster back in 2004. And Dell Worsham. This is the third time that these two have matched up. And Dell has won two of those. They're even, a 486, 314 miles an hour. Ashley Forrest goes to the semifinal.
I tell you, Dino, Guido's been doing a great job with Ashley Forrest's car. Runs that 478 in the first round. Then it gets a little bit warmer, a little bit trickier track conditions, and still lays down a nice 486. They've got a good race car.
As we mentioned, in just 2 weeks, they're at it again. It'll be the final race of this segment of the countdown. The Torco Racing Fuels Nationals qualifying comes up on Saturday, the 6th of October, and then finals, and NHRA Race Day comes up on October the 7th. John Force and Kenny Bernstein. There's a possibility Ashley and John could meet the way things are going here right now, but the winner of this will face Tony Pedregon in the semifinals.
And this is a good matchup right here. John Force knows that Kenny Bernstein is one of the best levers in the business. I guarantee you he's looking at it because he has in his past races with Kenny. And Kenny in the first round was about 0.05 of a second quicker in reaction time than John. So John knows he's got to dig deep, but he doesn't want to make the mistake. He's already had a couple red lights this year, doesn't need another one, but he can't let Kenny get too much of a jump on him because he's Kenny Bernstein.
Kenny Bernstein, his first ever NHRA race was in Dallas, not at this track, but in Dallas 37 years ago. He's still kicking butt.
The one thing, though, if John Force is watching everything, cars are really having a hard time getting down that right-hand lane. So it's one of those situations. Don't push it too hard. Don't be late, but don't push it too hard.
Well, John was a little late. There's a problem with his car. He comes across, he hits Bernstein. Both cars continue on. John's car is torn well up.
Wow, that was just a big crash.
That's frightening. You saw John Force's car comes down here with just the motor, and there is where the seat is, back in behind the wheels. Safety crew is there. His wife watches on from the start line. They're trying to get that car around to where they can get to John and hopefully get him out of that car.
Well, those cars are made to break apart at a hard impact right at the motor plate where it did, but still, that's a hard impact.
Something happened in John's car. It went away, broke, came over into the other lane. Then the two cars got together.
Went over, got near the center line, over it.
The broken front end of John's car continued all the way down the track, bouncing against the wall, and this part stopped right here. This is frightening.
Our vantage point, the tower directly behind the race.
Yeah, you hate to see that. I mean, especially all that damage. God, all we can hope is that John's okay.
You know, the one thing I don't see, Mike, is I see a lot of real concern from the medical types who are right there. It seems to be more a concern of how you get them out of the car. Ashley Forrest has just arrived on the scene.
We can see Kenny's car drifting toward the center line, fighting it to get it.
Crowd continues to watch. Lori watches from the start line. Ashley got in a golf cart right away and came down here. Of course, there are some crew members there as well who know the car better, of course, than anybody.
They may be trying to get the belts off of John to get him out of the car.
So the rest of the
And the word did just go out to fire up the emergency evacuation helicopter. But still, we have no indication at all as to John Force's condition. He is still strapped into the seat, underneath the roll hoop of that car, which broke away from the front end and the engine. Ashley is staying over here on the golf cart.
Get out of the race car.
Now she starts moving over toward the wall, but he's being a little protective of her. Like you say, Mike, part of the design is to get it to break, get rid of some of that energy. So in this case, that's what we hope has happened.
He is. I mean, and the other thing is, though, I mean, it was a hard enough impact to break it. So, I mean, that's a scary thing in itself, because even though, like you say, on a hard impact, they're supposed to break away, let the engine go one way, still, I mean, it's still got to be a pretty hard impact to do that.
Think of the things that have happened to this team this year. The death in Florida of Eric Medlin. Now this appears to be a very serious accident. Gary Gerald.
Well, we just talked with Dan Bricky, who is the medical director for NHRA. He is on the phone. They are firing up the helicopter. He said John is conscious. He has injuries to his lower extremities. They will fly him to a nearby hospital for further emergency treatment.
Saw John Medlin. You can imagine how his heart is beating. Conscious, injuries to lower extremity. Dan Bricky is now talking to Ashley. That's Dan with the sunglasses on the left. He directs the medical operations. Giving her the rundown is the family representative right here on the scene. Everybody else stayed up at the line. You saw Robert Hite standing alongside of John Medlin. Family really comes together. You see the chaplain from Racers for Christ right there. And they're getting information back here. It's not as if those on the starting line don't know what's going on there. There's plenty of communication going back and forth, and certainly not any more crowd is needed up at the accident site. Jimmy Prock talking to Robert Hite, and Kenny Bernstein is okay. They're going to pull that car back. Kenny Bernstein, the other car in that incident, and really the victim of whatever happened on John Force's car. Well, Mike, while we wait for further word, let's go back and see what we can find out about this run. Watch the car on the right.
Well, and the car on the left across the center lane, see the blocks fly over to the other side. I'm not positive that possibly something in the timing lights could have went over there, could have cut a tire on John's car. Obviously that's just speculation, but you did see the pieces come over there. So, I mean, Kenny Bernstein was disqualified from the run when he hit those blocks, giving the win to John. But then, obviously, the problem set in thereafter. Let's take another look at it. Kenny had the whole shot off of the starting line, had a good run, but look at the thing start moving around. It drifts over. Once you get out of the groove here, it's a wild ride. It's really hard, a handful here at the Texas Motorplex on the other end of that concrete. When it starts slip, when you get it out of the groove, it really gets loose, and you really got to do some driving. Right there, you see the car come over, and wow, that's a
big
hit.
Looked like something started to disintegrate in the right rear of John's car. After I didn't see the block, is that critically involved in it? But it may have been, as you said, Mike.
Well, I mean, it could possibly have been pieces that went over there and cut the tire. We don't know at this point. Let's take another look at it. I mean, John's, you know, got his car pretty much stuck in the groove. It's not moving around too much on the other end at this point. Kenny's ahead. He can probably see him. I don't know if Kenny was far enough ahead that they probably didn't see him. He wasn't that far ahead. Usually got to be more about a car length out. But then you see the right rear go on the car, and then that just drove the car over into Kenny's lane.
And with Kenny Bernstein crossing the center line, John Force, the car stayed in his lane, would come out as the winner of this. But then, of course, the car breaking in half after that disintegration. And John Force, they say, is conscious but has injuries to his lower extremities. So we'll wait until we hear some more definitive and accurate information to see exactly how John Force is after this horrifying accident with Kenny Bernstein, two great masters of the sport, slamming together against the wall in Dallas.
Chutes pulled the car apart. It was already broke, but when the chutes went out, it separated the car. I thought it was impact with the wall.
So we wait for information in Dallas, and let's say a prayer for both of them.
Do you send out those FTPs?
Back in Dallas, we are all still reeling over this accident that involved John Force and Kenny Bernstein. Back end of John's car just disintegrating and then the car breaking in half. Kenny Bernstein in that car right there, as you see, ricocheting off the wall. And right now, Kenny is with Gary Gerald.
Kenny, the kind of an incident that nobody ever wants to see. Cheryl comes over to join Kenny. What were you aware of in your lane? Everything happened so quickly.
Well, what I recall, everything, I was going down there, and I was moving towards the center line. The car just kept moving that way, and I was fighting it hard to bring it back, and then it kind of just stuck right there on that center line to the right of it, just a taste. I may have got across it. I don't really know. Yeah, and I got, thank you, Snake, and about the time I got to the finish line, I lifted and reached up and hit the chutes, and out of the corner of my eye, I saw John's car coming towards me and just collected me, and then everything just went black at that point in the sense of who couldn't see. He hit us, my body came up in the air, and I ran through his body and my body, and then the next thing I know, I'm coming out the other side. I see John hit the wall really hard to the right of me, and then I go past him, and I'm trying to, at that particular stage, to keep my car under control from hitting the wall too. And then I got under control and just coasted down there and stopped. And then all of a sudden, on my right-hand side, his chassis goes past me and goes off the end of the racetrack, and I don't see anything but the front half of the car. So I realize he's obviously back behind me somewhere. So that's what I recall.
Anyway, when something like this happens, and I know it's just happened, yeah, does it make you soul search and say, what in the world am I doing out here again?
Well, we're race drivers, and we all think about those things. I mean, there's not one of us out here that doesn't think about that, and you think about those things. And what you have to do is in a few days look at it and tell yourself, do you still want to do this? Do you still enjoy doing it? Do you still have the confidence to do it to that degree that it takes to win out here and to be a champion? And you got to understand, we all respect these race cars. We know what they can do to us. We realize what we're doing for a living. Many people think it's a hobby. It is not a hobby. It is a business, and it is a life-threatening business every time you go down the racetrack. So you have to combine yourself and think about all those things. And at this stage, you know, that's what you do, and then you decide whether you're going to go do it again. I look at it like sometimes when bad things happen, and I know, and I'm praying that John's going to be okay. I hope that everything there is going to be 100% for him. He's a great guy, a great person, a good friend of mine, and we'll just see how things go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, the good news is that Kenny Bernstein is all right. Now, you do know that this show is tape delayed, but we do have the latest in information on John Force given to us by his team. He has a compound fracture of his left ankle. He has an abrasion to his right knee that is all the way down to the bone, and therefore he has some possible tendon damage as well. His left wrist is dislocated and broken, and he has abrasions and broken fingers on his right hand. Now, the good news is they gave John a CAT scan, and it comes back negative, so that is good news. And, of course, racing does, in fact, go on. It's what John would have wanted, and it certainly is going to help occupy the rest of our time. We'll be back.
Remember that.
Well, we are back underway now. The course is clear, and this is the final pair of this round in Funny Car. On the right side of your screen, the right side of your screen is Tim Wilkerson, Cruz Pendergon in the other lane. John Force has been loaded into that AeroVac helicopter here at the track. He was waving, and he was talking to people as they were loading him in the helicopter. And Dave Reif is now with John Medlin.
John, obviously another difficult time for the John Force Racing family this year. First off, what did you see from the starting line, and what possibly was a contributing factor to this?
Well, it looked like Kenny's car crossed the center line, perhaps spinning the tire from the correction or whatever. It ran into the right-hand guardrail, then it made an immediate turn left, and looked like it intersected John's car somewhere at a 45-degree angle. And the rest we'll have to decide when we get the car here.
As difficult a year as this has been, how difficult a situation is this?
Oh my gosh, you can't even imagine. The preliminary report, he just has some lower extremity injuries. How severe they are, we don't know yet. They're transporting him to the hospital, but it appears that the cranial activity, he's talking, he's alert, and so there's a very good chance that what we've learned here so far has certainly helped in this kind of an accident. We have the crash accelerometers on the car, and Naranjo and the people who are forward, or they're at the scene right now making sure that we can extract that data. and continue to learn more. But our primary concern right now is John's health. I'm going to get to the hospital here so we can monitor the water race.
Thank you for the update, John. Your pillar of strength, as always.
You imagine how hard it is for that man. You saw Cruz Pedregon with a 487 at 317 miles an hour beat Tim Wilkerson. And we were talking about John Force, and as they were...
Let's take another look at it. I mean, left side of your screen, you're going to see Kenny get loose. Thing moves over towards center line, takes out the timing blocks, and then something left side of John's car goes. And then when the shoots out, it basically just pulls the back car away from the front of the chassis, which then just lets the front of the chassis go into Kenny's car, pushing them both into the wall. The big concern, though, that we can't see right now out of screen is where John's part of the car. You can see him right over there. He's off against the wall on the other side over there. Wow, that was scary.
And there you see, as they have him loaded foot forward in the helicopter and just kind of pushed his foot over against the Colling. But the good news is he's moving both of his feet. He is conscious. You saw him. He's given instructions to everybody, including Robert Height, as they loaded him in. And Gary Gerald caught up with Lori Force.
Lori, you have an opportunity to talk to John before they transported him.
He's in the ambulance and can't really communicate. He is talking. He's shouting out orders, asking if he won. And so, yeah, he's talking. But and I told him I was there and Ashley's there and he's calling for Robert. So, yeah, and they're like doing everything. So I think his legs are, I don't know, maybe his legs are broken and he looks a little bloody everywhere. So.
All right, we'll let you get on with it as they send him to the hospital. Thank you.
Thank you.
So hard for those who have to stand and watch. They perhaps understand even more than those who drive the cars how difficult and how dangerous it is. So John Force now being airlifted out of the track here at the Texas Motorplex. And the last word that we had, and we could confirm visually, he's conscious. He's talking with people. He has injuries to his lower extremity, and it's something that truly shocked this crowd here. It shocked everybody. You see something like that, it makes you stop and think of the human frailty and how a man can master these 8,000 horsepower machines and beat them time and time again, but every now and then they do get the upper hand. So with some other questions about what may happen now, Cruz Pedregon will face Ashley Force, who has lane choice as they go to the semifinal round. And Mike Dunn, the question mark is over here. John Force is airlifted, so that's just going to be a bye for Tony.
That will give Tony a single, but I think the big question is whether Ashley will press on and run that semifinal against Tony's brother Cruz.
And Gary Gerald caught up with Ashley Force at the accident scene, too.
Ashley, in this situation, I know the concern for your dad, and they send him on to the hospital, but you also have advanced through this field. What is your decision right now? Will you continue to race?
I don't know what we're doing yet, and I don't think we're looking that far ahead. I know Dad would be mad if I didn't continue racing, but our team wants to get over there and see what's happened with him. But he was talking and wanted to know who won, wanted to know if Kenny was okay. So it sounds he's his old self, so we'll just pray that everything's all right.
Thanks.
Thank you.
John Force, air-evac from the track at Texas after a horrifying accident. And the racing, it always continues on, as Ashley Force just suggested. He feels that that's exactly what John Force would want, and no doubt when he gets on the ground, he'll try to get a hold of a phone, call back, and find out what's happening here. But we all do wish him well.
Hey, Dwayne, this project is...
Back in Texas, it's Pro Stock that comes to the line now as we get ready to set the stage for the next round of competition, and we will continue to monitor the information on John Force, the Lucas Oil Pro Stock ladder. In round two here, again, two contenders, Greg Anderson and Larry Morgan, come up against one another.
And Dave Conley's going to go up against Max Naylor, and Richie Stevens will face off with Jason Lyons.
But right now, it's Justin Humphreys and Alan Johnson. Now, Justin took out one of the contenders, Kurt Johnson, in round one. Will he do it again? away, Alan Johnson continues to move forward and continues his hopes in the countdown. Here are the Pro Stock points updated to this moment. Dave Conley and Greg Anderson both have clinched their positions.
See in the bottom four, only Jason Lyon, Larry Morgan still in the show trying to help their cause out.
And Jason Lyon, 38 points back, was runner-up here in 2005 to Greg Anderson. He will face the kid, Richie Stevens, who is becoming an adult. He turns 29 this week. A little more update on the John Force situation with Robert Height.
And I'm with Robert Height down in the pits. And Robert, we saw you helping them load John onto the helicopter to be taken to the hospital. What did he say to you?
Well, you know, John was he was his old self. You know, he wanted the interview. You know, that's what he really missed the most. He kept saying, I want my interview. I won, right, Robert? I said, yes, you did, John. Anyway, he wanted that interview to get all those sponsors in there. But he also wanted to let Brittany and Courtney and Adria and Autumn at home know that he's good. And something else he was real worried about was, did I make the countdown? I said, yep, for now you're in, John.
All right, there he is, always the racer. Thank you, Robert.
Robert Height, of course, John Force's son-in-law. No real surprise here. Jason Lyon cuts a brilliant light, maybe even too close, and runs a 670 at 206, and he moves forward. NASCAR coverage continues next weekend at Kansas City on ESPN and on ABC. Rolling into Kansas, Nextel Cup has 8 races left in the chase for the Nextel Cup. 06 at Busch winner was Kevin Harvick, and Tony Stewart won the Nextel. And that last run for Jason moved him up to fifth. There is Greg Anderson, has already clinched number one in the countdown. Larry Morgan is in the other lane, and they are both, of course, in the fight for the countdown. Greg Anderson, 669, takes out Larry Morgan. Anderson clinched a spot. I think I may have said number one, but he clinched a spot. Dave Conley already had clinched the number one position.
Boy, this was all Greg Anderson from start to finish. Larry Morgan was late. Greg got the jump off the start and never looked back, being in that good right-hand lane. He runs low ET of the round with a great 669.
And the final pair, Max Naylor and Dave Conley. Max Naylor gives him a pretty good run, but Dave Conley runs a 668, 206.
Damn, baby, that was close down there.
So Dave Conley takes the win over Max Naylor and will face Jason Lyon in the semis.
Well, I'm bored with Dave. This was just a great drag race. Both drivers had good reaction times. Dave Conley just had a little bit better car at the end. The 668, 206 miles per hour, gets him the win by almost half a car length.
And all four of those who will race in the semis are also in the countdown. Greg Anderson with lane choice over Alan Johnson. And Dave Conley and Jason Lyon will face one another. Dave Conley will have lane choice. And the points continue to move around. One and two will there clinch, Conley and Anderson. And look at the rest of them, Mike.
Look at that. With Jed Coughlin out, if Jason can win the next round, he moves into that fourth position.
So let's look ahead to Pro Stock Motorcycle and round two. Peggy Llewellyn, she is a must-win. Angel Sampei, that's a must-win as well. And Peggy Llewellyn is coming to the line for a must-win alongside of Karen Stover.
Good race.
A 705-188 to a losing 706. Peggy Llewellyn's doing what she needs to do. Remember, Craig Trouble is out, and so both Angel and Peggy need to go rounds in order to put him complete of the countdown.
Wow, you saw Peggy have to lean off the side of the bike about half track, and look how close that was at the finish line. Great race.
And Chip Ellis, the number one qualifier. Fast bike, hasn't been to a final round this season. And Eddie Krawick. Ellis is a 698, 190 miles an hour. And Chip Ellis is looking good. Dave Reif now has Tony Pedregon,
who worked for John Force Racing for 8 years. And Tony, when something like that happens to somebody that's really so close, granted a competitor, it sort of brings us right back into reality very quickly.
Well, it really does. You know, we have a tendency to treat this as competitors would, like football players, like boxers. So mentally, we have to approach this that way. But when something like that happens, it is pretty scary, and it sure does put things in perspective. It's like turning the news on at night, because sometimes that's what you have to do. And my biggest concern, I was at the end of the track watching it on the screen. The scariest thing for me was I jumped the fence, and I saw a chassis coming down, and I, you know, not real qualified, but I wanted to be there on site in case I could do anything, and there wasn't any cockpit. And you know, I was just waiting to know that he was conscious. I heard from a good source. I don't want to speculate on you know, any damages, but if he was aware and conscious, then I was good with that, because I know how tough he is. And you know, I'm a little shaken, but I know what I have to do. We need to get my head right back in this. We've got a lot of sponsors we got to take care of, but I am real happy to hear that John's going to be okay.
Tony should get the single here coming up. And guys, he was down there, shouted a reassurance to John and reminded him that he is the man as they loaded him into the ambulance.
Hector Arana and Matt Smith go head-to-head with one another. And what a run that was, but Smith takes the win.
Wow, you talk about a close race. 0.3 of a second separates him at the line. Wow, you can't tell that one with the naked eye.
Final pair, Pro Stock Motorcycle, as we set up the semifinals for this gal, Angel Sampei. This is an absolute must win against Andrew Hines.
She was late.
And that one is Andrew Hines on the hole shot. As you suggested, Mike, Angel Sampei does not go into the semifinals, and that is going to really cream her position in the countdown.
Well, that's her fifth hole shot loss of the year. That's a tough way to go out.
Pro Stock Motorcycle final matchups then are Chip Ellis and Peggy Llewellyn, who is still doing everything she needs to do. And on the other side, it'll be Andrew Hines and Matt Smith. Andrew Hines and Matt Smith are both already locked into their positions in the countdown.
87.
And outside of John Force's pit area, the crowd just standing there, just paying their respects. NHRA.com has reported out that John Force has two broken legs and an injury to an arm. But beyond that, no real definition. We do know that he was conscious and talking to everybody, barking out orders as they loaded him into the helicopter. We'll be back with more from Texas.
I'm gonna go get us some drinks.
Okay. So much emotion in so many different ways here at Texas. Some of it good, elation because they're moving forward, frustration, and total disappointment. Angel Sampei is out of the countdown in the Pro Stock Motorcycle, and Gary Gerald has her.
Well, the gallant fight is now over in terms of this new playoff format. The emotions must be tough, Angel. Can you share them with us?
I had the Suzuki to win, obviously. I was late on the tree again. I don't really know where that's coming from. I was really pushing it this time. It wasn't like it used to be with trying not to red light, so I don't know what happened on that one. First and foremost, I hope that John Force is okay. God bless him and his family. I guess I have to go back and face my team now. This is going to be tough because we lost our sponsorship and now we lost the championship. So, and that was all my fault just now. So it's really hard to go back. You know, people can say what they want to say about us racers and judge us by what we say in interviews and how we act. You know, put yourself in my shoes. I have to go back and face seven guys now and tell them that it was all my fault. We changed engines before this run, and obviously they did their job. I just didn't do mine.
Well, Angel Sampei with great disappointment, and now we take a look, Talk Fuel semifinal. It's going to be Clay Milliken and Larry Dixon. We'll show you the Lucas Oil ladder. This run, and then Whip Bazemore and Bob Vandergrift. And that's really the key one. Bob Vandergrift, if he can win this race, can move very close to getting into that countdown within a point.
And they're both hoping that Clay Milliken can take out Brandon Bernstein right now. So far, Clay's been pretty good at taking out the drivers in that countdown to four. Larry Dixon has a very good race car right now. Clay Milliken's been doing a great job driving. I still say Larry Dixon's one of the best. I mean, very consistent, not only, you know, with the race car, but with his driving ability all year long.
Mike, I talked to Larry Dixon's crew chief, Donnie Bender. He says they're running the competition. They think the track will hold a 59, but they've softened it up a bit. They're only going to try and run a 60.
So Clay Milliken not been to a final round since Atlanta of 2004. He is 0-3 in final rounds. Larry Dixon, he leads the points for the first time since he won his championship back in 2003. And you know Dixon is always stout when he comes to the line. Larry Dixon steadily pulls away, takes the win of 458, 322 miles an hour. That puts Larry Dixon into the Top Fuel final.
Wow, great job by Larry Dixon and the team. Said they wanted to run a 460. They ran a 458. Probably made everything happen just right. I mean, that's a good call, just to go out there and make that nice of a pass. Take a look at it. Clay had a slight advantage off the starting line. Not enough to obviously leave on Larry by too much, and Larry just had the horsepower and drove around about a car length at the finish line. One more with Larry. Watch the groove. You see the groove on the right side. He moves over just a little bit towards the finish line out of it, but still makes a very nice run.
So Larry Dixon goes to the final. The last time he went to a final round here was his win in 2001. And again, tracking those Top Fuel point standings, Mike Dunn, Larry Dixon on top, followed by Fuller, Schumacher, and Bernstein. But Bob Vandergrift had a chance to move not into the top, but close to the top.
Yeah, you're number five and six. Going head-to-head right here, Bob Vandergrift and Whit Bazemore. Big race for both these drivers.
Bob Vandergrift, he's been to three final rounds prior to this season, prior in this season, Vegas, Bristol, Sonoma. Bazemore, he's just trying to keep those playoff hopes alive. Lee Beard, final check to get Whit Bazemore forward for the burnout. And let's go up to the far end and Gary Gerald.
Larry Dixon comes out after running a 58 and a solid pass. One of the great historians and a lover of this sport, when you see something that happened to John Force, does that impact you and does it make your job that much more difficult, Larry?
Well, I mean, it makes me feel very comfortable with the NHRA rule package and how these cars are built, that he can go through something like that and survive an accident like that. I get in my car and that's my world. I mean, it feels like you could run over a landmine, but I know my car's gonna save my ass. So, sorry about that, but that's how I feel.
Thank you.
Thanks.
And Larry Dixon, that is a good point, Mike. You take hope from the fact that the engineering was there to work.
Well, that's it. As a driver, you gotta be confident that everything's built as well as it can be. You know, there's things can happen, but once you get in the car, you can't think. If you're thinking about that when you start driving, it's time to basically call it quits and retire.
You can imagine, though, how difficult it must be for all of the competitors here to climb back in the machines after seeing an incident like that. And you just got a glimpse of that sticker that they have on all of the cars for Eric Medlin. That is certainly on their mind as well. The tires, Bob Vandergrift is going to his first Dallas final.
Wow, how about Bob Vandergrift? He's keeping it alive, isn't he? Great job by Jim Dupuis and the rest of that team. Runs a 4:59, makes a good ride to get him in the final round going up against Larry Dixon.
And so Bob Vandergrift ruins the day for Whit Bazemore and messes badly with the championship as well. And if he comes out of this event with a win, then he will just be 1 point behind the countdown.
I'm very proud to say that I work on a professional drag racing team. And Wyotech's what got me there. They know what they're talking about. They teach their kids to get out there and do what needs to be done, be at the professional level. It can take you places. It'll take you places fast. Most people think, hey, you know, you're covered in oil all day long. What are you thinking? It's a love.
The NHRA chose Wyotech. Who are you going to choose? Call now. 1-800-414-0219.
The NHRA Power 8 Countdown.
Don't stop, don't quit. You can go hard or go home. Give it all you got. You got a choice to make. Do you really want it? You can go hard or go home. And watch TV. You got a choice to make. So what's it gonna be? Go hard or go home.
Well, at Texas, funny cars are coming to the line, and there are some changes here, as you might well imagine. Let's go to Gary Gerald.
Dean Guido Antonelli is the crew chief for Ashley Force, and he and his team have come to a very difficult decision regarding whether or not Ashley would continue to compete. Tell us what that decision is, Guido.
Well, you know, as all of us, we've had a pretty emotional year this year, and John had a pretty bad wreck, and just to make sure everybody's head was right, we didn't think it was probably the right choice to go out and run immediately. You know, Ashley is concerned about her father, and we had a good race car, and we're sorry to all our sponsors, but, you know, we just wanted to do the right thing and you know, just make sure everybody's thinking right before you get in the race car, or even myself or Ron Douglas tuning in the car. You know, we all have jobs to do, and it's emotional right now. We just tried to do what we think is right, and, you know, we'll put it away, and we'll go to the next race.
Appreciate the update. Wish you well.
Thank you.
Well, sad to see all that happening, too. You know, Ashley, she was looking very strong today, but it's certainly understandable. Here's Tony Pedregon.
It was absolutely the right decision, you know. I mean, since the death of Eric Medlin, I mean, the other thing I remember, they've been making changes to this chassis to make sure, to make these cars safe and everything. You know, they need to go back and make sure, you know, review all that and make sure some of those changes haven't helped cause the car to break apart the way it did. And it's just one of those things that you really got to look everything over, and it's just the right decision to set out for this round.
And if you're just joining us, here is Kenny Bernstein on the left, John Forrest on the right. And then something goes terribly wrong with John Force's car. Hits the wall, breaks in half. Bernstein and the front half of John Force's car goes down the track. John is in there in the back half. And the news is he's been transported to Baylor Hospital. He has injuries to his legs and to an arm. And we're waiting for further details on the situation. But that's what we have right now. So Tony Pedregon is into the final, and because of the Ashley Force withdrawal, Cruz Pedregon is going to bring it up to the line. And you assume that he's going to try to get lane choice out of this fight.
Absolutely.
Tony runs a 486.307. I think I may have said Cruz earlier as well. Tony Pedregon runs a 486.307. John?
In the staging lanes just a few minutes ago, I was talking with Tony Pedregon. Of course, everybody knows he used to drive for John Force. They're very, very close. He said, I have to do my job right now, get in the car, even though I may not want to. I've got to get my head right. He says, I don't know if I'll be able to get my head right unless I'm able to stay in Dallas and go see John in the hospital tomorrow. So very, very concerned about his old boss.
What has happened here, of course, Ashley Force withdraws after John Force is in the accident, which would have moved him into the semifinals, but he's in the hospital, and so the Pedregons, Cruz and Tony, both have to make that solo run, and they will face one another in the final round. Don't forget that our coverage of the NHRA Power 8 Drag Racing Series continues on. It is the last race oven for Pro Stock and for Funny Car and for Top Fuel, and it'll be at Richmond in 2 weeks. Last race for points. And so we've seen the one run. And this is where Ashley Force would have come up alongside of Cruz Pedregon. But again, because of the withdrawal, which is because of the accident, this will also be a solo run. Back in the John Force pits, they're still thinking about it a little bit, putting things away. Obviously, nothing's going to run. You already know that. But you can see that pretty quiet back there right now. And the crowd was there for a while, just standing very quietly. So we take you back up to the line. Here is Cruz Pedregon. His last final round of this year was at Bristol. His last win on the tour, Las Vegas, in spring of 06. And he is looking to face his brother. If he races, makes it through here, you assume that he will, he's going to race his brother, and it would be the first time that the Pedregons face one another as team members.
Crew Chief Ron Tobler there looking at the aisle, going to make the final adjustments before Cruz goes in to do the burnout.
So we're looking at the first potential final round confrontation for the Pedregon brothers in their own team. The points, we'll update those in Funny Car right now while Cruz backs it up. And you look down there all the way through Mike Ashley, and look how close that is. John Force, despite the accident, still sits there number four. It's tight. It's getting tighter.
And if Tony
not getting worse, it's getting tighter.
Tony wins in the final round, wins the race, he will take over the point lead. But right now, Cruz Pedregon, he's going to be focusing on getting lane choice, try to keep that thing stuck right down in the middle. And to get lane choice, he'll have to run quicker than a 486.7 to get lane choice for the final. Right now, everybody in the fuel categories love the left-hand lane. It seems like the right-hand lane gets a little bit loose in the middle, more so than that left-hand lane. So lane choice will be important in that final round.
Ron Tobler, there he is, tuning and working on this funny car. First time on funny cars, and he's doing a pretty good job of it.
Yeah, I mean, they struggled, came out and DNQ'd the first few races with Ron, but Ron's one of those guys, he's very meticulous. He just keeps whittling away at it, make sure, you know, he's very good at making sure all the systems work right so that he can get some good runs in there. And then he came out and got, once he got a baseline, thing went down the track without anything going wrong. I mean, it's just been getting better and better. He's been doing a good job up to this point.
So let's see what Cruz can do. Can he get lane choice, take it away from his brother?
Nope, cylinder out.
So the Pedregons will go to the final round. Cruz runs a 496.310, and that'll give lane choice over to Tony Pedregon, and the Pedregons will face one another in the funny car final round. There are the matchups for you. And as we suggested, Tony has the lane choice on the strength of that 486. And so funny car semifinals are now complete after a most interesting day thus far. And the good news is that when he left the track, John Force was alert, awake, and suffering, though, from injuries to his legs and to an arm. Let's go to John Kernan. He has Brandon Bernstein.
Of course, his father, Kenny, was involved in that crash with John Force. But Brandon, back to the business at hand, the countdown. Dropped down to fourth, only 1 point ahead of Bob Vandegrift.
Yeah, it's tough. You know, that's a good team over there, that UPS car. And, you know, we just stumbled this weekend. Our Budweiser Lucas Oil just stumbled. And it's going to be interesting. I mean, you know, if he doesn't win, then I guess we're 1 point ahead of him. But that's not enough points. And going into Richmond, it's going to make it awful dramatic.
It'll make it dramatic for them, stressful for them, but I think it'll be enjoyable for us.
No, you bet it will. Gary Gerald?
Well, with Cruz Pedregon, and you don't get the lane choice, which I know you probably would have preferred having, but let me ask you quickly about how this business of Ron Tobler, Dickie Venables meshing together, what it's meaning to you and your team.
Well, it's meaning a lot. It's meaning everything. We're in the finals. The car's been, I think it's made 10 or 11 runs in a row. without spinning the tires and pulling the parachutes every run. I haven't done that, and we probably haven't done that in years. But that's thanks to Advance Auto Parts for sticking with me. You know, they've been a great sponsor, and well, along with Snap-on, Autolite, Q, everybody. But great stuff. It really means a lot to our team. My crew guys have been working their tails off, and we had three DNQs. But I knew bringing Ron in would take a little while. He's actually picked up this funny car thing pretty a little quicker, but hey, we'll have a tough final. It's great to be in the final for Advance and everybody, like I said, but Tony's going to be a formidable opponent. I think we dropped a cylinder. We'll fix that and see what happens. Thank you.
And so that stage is now completely set. And again, we look at the John Forrest pit. That's Bernie Federle. Boy, nobody knows the construction and operation of these cars as good as Bernie. And when we come back, Dave Reif will have a chance to talk with him.
MSD.
Back at the O'Reilly NHRA Fall Nationals, Greg Anderson and Alan Johnson set to go semifinals in pro stock as Bernie Federle joins me back in a very quiet John Force pit area. And Bernie, I know you're part of the bread and butter of this operation that kind of keeps this cohesive unit cohesive. Where does this team go from here?
Well, right now we're just in a holding pattern. We're just sort of getting regrouped here a little bit. And, obviously our primary concern is for John's welfare. And we're not sure exact condition at this point. That's our primary focus. And we'll just, get everything gathered up here. And we'll have a meeting here in a while and decide what our course of action will be.
Thank you.
And he knows what we've already told you. We're all waiting for more definitive information from Baylor Hospital, Lucas Oil Pro Stock ladder for the semifinal. And as you can see, everybody there, Mike Dunn, is in contest in the countdown.
So some big races here. Right now, Greg Anderson has a car. Alan Johnson has his work cut out for him. I mean, Greg's been running about 3 or 4 hundredths of a second quicker all day long. And they made that fantastic run yesterday afternoon in that final session. But Alan Johnson, I mean, you can't cut him any slack. He's very good on the lights. His dad Roy's been making good horsepower this year. Seems like they're a little bit off here this weekend in comparison with Greg. Maybe just the fact that Greg's just really got a handle on that car finally for this race, because he's definitely been up and down this year. It's not the Greg Anderson we've seen with the domination in the past.
Look at that light, 004 for Johnson. Is that gonna help? No. Greg Anderson, 668, 206 miles an hour, goes to his fourth final round in the last six races.
Yeah, I think that lane choice might have hurt him. Alan Johnson just spun the tires big time. He is 102 and 60 feet. But, you know, you got to go for it against Greg. You know, you're trying to make up 3 or 4 hundredths, although Alan made up of almost 3 hundredths at the starting line. But Greg Anderson was able to drive around. You saw the margin of victory right there, about a quarter car length at the stripe.
And so now we have one half of the final round. It will be Greg Anderson. And Alan Johnson, he's got some small issues now in his point standings. Jason Lyne, though, he really needs to lay something down here against Dave Conley.
You see, he's 18 points out of the top four, 20 points around. So if he wins this round against Dave Conley, not only will he be an all KB racing final, but it will put him into that countdown to four for the time being with one more race to go.
And there's Dave Conley, looking to keep his number one position, looking to go to his fourth final round in a row. Jason's having a pretty good day as Greg Anderson watches on his teammate Dave.
Oh, Jason dribbles the tree.
Can you believe that number? And yet, Conley comes back with a 6.7206. Against the 001 reaction time.
Wow. Jason Lyne definitely did his job on the starting line, just didn't have the car down there. That left-hand lane seems to be a lot, not quite as good as the right-hand lane for the pro stock cars anyway, but let's take another look at it. I mean, 1,000th of a second from perfect was Jason Lyne. And obviously, he needed to get the jump on Dave Conley. Dave Conley was 031/300 behind, but was able to drive around. You see the margin of victory, about like the other race, about a quarter of a car length.
And for the third race in a row, Dave Conley will meet Greg Anderson in the final, Gary.
And it's good to be a habit. You and Conley here in the finals. What do you think you got for him today after you throw down a nice 68 there?
It was definitely a nice lap, and it looks like for a change we got a lane choice, which we haven't had in the last two cracks. So I guess I got the break I needed. Now I just need to make something out of it. We need to win this race. Those guys at Summit have been great to us, and my Pontiac GTO is great, and I need to win a race. It feels like it's been a long time. I don't want to cry and sound like a whiner because, geez, I've had runner-ups, and that's pretty doggone good, but I'm getting tired of getting beat by David over there. He's doing a whale of a job, and then the guys are throwing 00 lights at me. Man, old guy like me don't stand a chance.
004 light, Alan Johnson, you're doing everything you can to stay alive here in this countdown to four. Your quick thoughts about what's just transpired.
Yeah, you know, we threw everything we had at him. We all knew we had to be perfect. We didn't make that good a run. John, I noticed Jason in the same lane, that left lane just a little tricky. But, you know, we done good today. We'll have a couple of rounds, maybe cushion and go to Richmond and try to stay in there.
All right, thanks, Alan. All right.
Now back at the line, Andrew Hines, Matt Smith, could be a preview of the last two races for the championship of the top of the best in pro stock motorcycle this year. There's a race for you. Andrew Hines with a 707 to Matt Smith, 708.
Just another great drag race there. I mean, he saw Matt Smith. It looked like the bike wanted to make a move over to the left. Watch the right side of your screen. He's got to hang off of the left side of that bike pretty good, right about there, and he reels it back in. You know, and Andrew was working his pretty good. Neither of them were perfect runs, but the result is Andrew Hines gets the win by about half a bike length there.
And here's how we come down to the semifinal round, and next up is going to be a most interesting confrontation. Chip Ellis and Peggy Llewellyn. It's a must win for Peggy. She is a teammate with Chip Ellis. She can get that other round, then Craig Treble, who is out early in the competition, and Craig Treble goes out and Peggy makes it into the final countdown. Well, so what happens? There's a rule that you can't really just completely lay down on the...
Well, they run on the same, you know, the S&S Buell banner. George Bryce is involved with both bikes, but they're two different owners, so I don't know. I can't say one way or another, but, you know, the key is right here, Peggy Llewellyn. I mean, she's got to win this round and win the race.
Oh, and she does. Peggy Llewellyn, a 7-11 to a 7-10 with a 9. Peggy Llewellyn is going to the final to face Andrew Hines.
And Paul, you can credit a lot of the success at her climb up the point standing, because remember last week at Memphis she was eighth going in, moved up a couple spots there trying to move up here. You can credit that to some work they did at Valdosta following the U.S. Nationals. The clutch was just so tight at the U.S. Nationals it wouldn't slip, so they did a lot of work with that before heading to Memphis. It worked last week. She made it to the semifinals. Had she shifted harder on the button last week, she may have gone to her first final, but they got that bike running very well.
How great for Peggy as she goes to her first final round, where she will face Andrew Hines. Andrew Hines has the lane choice. And how about Dave Conley? He's with Gary Gerald.
Well, for the third consecutive event, it's the Greg and Dave show here. Although this time you do not have the lane choice. How much does that concern you, Dave?
You know, Dallas, this place has been pretty good about just keeping lanes pretty even. And there might be a little bit of difference. You know, we might be a little bit of disadvantage, but we're just happy to take this Torco Race Fuels Chevy Cobalt in another final, get to race Greg again. So I mean, his odds are starting to turn. He's got to beat us one of these times, but we're going to do our best up there. And you know, the big thing is that we get to go up there and race again. When you see things that, you know, happen to John Ford like they did, it just it really knocks the wind out of your sail. And as long as we can go down there and both of us turn off the end of the track, that'll be a good day for me.
Thank you, David.
So Dave Conley looking forward to meeting with Greg Anderson. And it's time now for a Valvoline garage tip. Here is Mike Dunn.
You see the Cruz Pentagon team just getting their car back into the pits, and they will start ripping that thing apart and get ready. Now remember, they dropped a cylinder in the previous run. Normal maintenance, no matter what happens, you're pulling all eight pistons out, you're pulling the heads off it. Normally, it depends on the team, but most of them will just have another set of cylinder heads that they'll put on there, and then they'll service those parts during the course of the week when they have more time. That's why they look pretty relaxed, because they know, you know, we have the parts are ready to go. Let's just take everything apart, put it back together, and let's go up there and race our brother Tony.
Gary Gerald has. Peggy Llewellyn, she's got to be happy as they get that helmet off, G-Man.
If they can get it off, she's having a hard time getting her gloves off. Everything's taped up here so tight, and when you're excited, those fingers don't work quite as nimbly, but they're best. And we'll hang on here, and we'll see. She becomes the 11th woman in the history of NHRA drag racing competition to make it to a finals. And we're going to find out eventually here how she's feeling about that. How excited are you, Miss Llewellyn?
I'm just so excited about this. I had to get that semifinal monkey off my back, and it's just awesome for my team. They won that full throttle award. And I'm going to try and bring Wally home to go with that award on this Rush Racing Products fuel.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
And there's Peggy's run and the reaction down at the start line after it. As expected, big celebration as she goes to her first ever final. And the points.
Help pack my parachute when I was doing the clutch and didn't have enough time, but my buddy Wayno would pack them in there, and I always knew it was going to be right, but there was other times that I did it myself, and obviously Larry likes to do it, and it's a process of putting that thing in basically the way it comes out, with that pilot chute pulling out first, pulling the canopy out, then with the shroud lines, the air catches it, and then boy, when you can really feel it when that chute hits at 330 miles per hour.
Larry Dixon, he gets ready for his final round matchup with Bob Vandergriff, and then over in Tony Pedregon's pit, he's getting ready to meet up with his brother. They're right alongside one another there in the pits. It's final rounds that are coming up.
Later on.
Well, we're getting closer to resolving positions in the countdown to the championship. One guy who is in there, but his fate is going to be determined by others, is Craig Treble. Right now, he's with Gary Gerald.
Well, a very unique situation here. We've talked about how this new playoff format is providing all kinds of drama. As you well know, today is the last opportunity to make the countdown for four in Pro Stock Motorcycle. Craig Treble isn't going to be racing anymore today, but his future is very much on the line because, quite simply, Peggy Llewellyn wins the finals. She's in, you're out. She loses the finals, you're in the countdown. What in the world are your nerves like, and how are you planning to watch this crucial showdown that impacts your future this season?
Well, I don't know if I'm going to be watching it. I'm trying to get a ride out here to go back to Little Rock, but, you know, this is very similar to the Redding situation. You know, my fate was in somebody else's hands, and it worked out in the nick of time, and I ended up in the first countdown, and right now, you know, I'm crossing my fingers, and I'm Andrew Hines' biggest fan right now, I can promise you that. So he already paid me back once today, but hopefully I'll owe him one after this race.
Of course, he has a U.S. Nationals victory to his credit this year. Nobody's going to take that one away. He wants to be greedy. He wants to go for the championship. Don't blame him at all.
Yeah, why not? And Larry Dixon gets ready, begins to warm up the car. And Mike Dunn, that sets up our Chucker Shucks Kragen Tractionary.
And that's the process of seating the clutch, the process of loading the clutch pack to allow the clutch disc and floaters to properly align with each other before the run. And how this is done, you can watch Larry Dixon. He's going to let the clutch pedal hold the brake, and then they're going to hit the throttle. Whap. One more time, maybe. And that's how that is done in their pit. Some of the other teams actually just rev it up or just let it go up against an idle, but they like to hit the throttle, and the fans love it.
Oh, the fans just flock right over every time they hear a nitro motor fire up. They like the fumes, they like the noise. So the final rounds are coming up, and what about Bob Vandergriff? 10 times he has tried to win the final. Will this be the time? Depends on Larry Dixon.
I was browsing behavior.
This ESPN production is also available on ESPN 2HD, presented by Sharp Aquas. Well, the music is about to stop for Pro Stock Motorcycle. We are ready for the final rounds, and there will only be 4 chairs left when the music does stop. Top Fuel, well, let's see what's coming up there when we go to finals. Bob Vandergriff, 10 times he's made it to a final. He's never won one. In order to win this one, he is going to have to go through Larry Dixon, who really understands how to win. And then in Funny Car, the Pedregon brothers, Tony and Cruz, will face one another. First time since they put the team together, they've faced one another in a final. And Dave Conley and Greg Anderson, this gets to be old hat. They're going to face one another in the final once again. Pro Stock Motorcycle, Andrew Hines. He's number one in the points. Peggy Llewellyn is looking to get into the finals of the countdown. She can do it if she can win the final. Mike Dunn, here's the weather.
Air temperature up at 91 degrees, 86 water grains per pound. Air track temperature still relatively warm, 117 degrees, and that density altitude is corrected out at over 3,300 feet.
And we begin with Pro Stock Motorcycle, Andrew Hines and Peggy Llewellyn. And I'm sure somewhere on the sidelines, Craig Treble is watching this and holding his breath, because if Peggy Llewellyn can win this, then she will move into that fourth and final position in the countdown. She doesn't, Craig Treble stays there. Andrew obviously is safe.
And we talk about the pressure of being in the countdown. There doesn't get any more pressure than what's on Peggy Llewellyn right now. She's in her first final round. She's up to against the three-time defending Powerade champion, and she has to not only win the race, but she has to win the race just to get into the countdown.
Mike, she's got an ace up her sleeve in George Bryce, one of the best people ever, about getting a rider in the zone, focused. I asked him what he said to her heading into this monumental race. He says, Peggy, just act like you're at South Georgia Motorsports Park where we test. Put yourself there. Go through the shift and the procedure. Just act like you're there. Relax. Go out and have some fun, and we'll make the countdown.
Good advice from one of the best. Ready.
Good line by Peggy.
Oh, great line by Peggy. Where's this going?
Oh, wow.
Peggy Llewellyn.
Oh, hole shot.
On that hole shot. And she becomes the ninth female to win in NHRA history as a pro, the third in Pro Stock Motorcycle. The legacy of George Bryce continues. Think of that long list of racers that he has put in winner's circle. He has done it once again.
And Paul, that number would be nine, including yourself, now that you've put in the winner's circle. And she did. She put herself right there at South Georgia Motorsports Park, exactly like you told her to.
She did exactly what we planned. She said, what do I do? I've never been here. I said, yes, you are. South Georgia Motorsports Park test session. Just make a good run, get a good light.
Right up next.
Thank you,
good
Carl,
job,
Clement, and Kim, my G2 guys. I'm sorry I'm so out of breath. I held my breath, I think. But anyway, Peggy, what a superstar. She's doing great. Thank you, guys. I love it.
One of the best in the business right there.
And so the countdown to the championship in Pro Stock Motorcycle is now set. That was a celebration on the line. Whoa. And at the far end, Peggy Llewellyn, remember she had all the trouble getting gloves and helmets off. Gary, can she get it off this time?
Oh, she got it off, and much quicker, and she is hugging that Wally, and the emotion begins to flow. Do you realize what you've just accomplished? You're in the countdown to four. You become the ninth woman to win in NHRA history. What does it all mean to you at this moment right now, Peggy?
I'm speechless, and I don't want to forget anyone. I want to tell Carl and Kim Clement thank you. Tell Kim we've come a long way from the Houston's restaurant. I want to thank George and Shane and Garrett for, you know, tuning this bike to go rounds and Rush Racing Products, for coming aboard with us. And I'd like to just thank all my family and friends are down here. And I just want to say a special thank you to my dad for putting me on a motorcycle when I was seven.
Congratulations. We'll see you in the countdown to four.
And the acknowledgement of the crowd and the Pro Stock Motorcycle countdown to four is now set. And Peggy Llewellyn, by winning, puts herself into it.
It looks like Greg Anderson might have leaked something. I don't know. His car's still lit. We're going to see what happens. They're celebrating a win over here.
Dana Sherman, you got the first report on the line. And yeah. Look at that. Nella tells us that Dave Connolly's okay. Well, our guys on the line gave it to you right away. Dave Connolly's going to take the run. Craig Anderson is already done.
Hi, baby.
He crosses the line. There it is. Dave Conley with another win. Talk about drama, Mike Dunn.
Wow, when it's your day, it's your day. I tell you what, it was probably lucky for Dave Conley that Greg had the palms, because he had a great reaction time, but boy, you saw the car get pretty loose when he launched it. That's the reason why he shut off. He knew he'd already had the win. A tough break for Greg Anderson, but great job for that man. Victor Cagnazzi has put a great team together, and Dave Conley is a great driver.
Well, Greg Anderson climbs out and says, I don't know what that was, but I sure didn't do anything with it. John Kernan has Andrew Hines.
Andrew will go into the countdown to one, the number one seed. Andrew, you got a few weeks off before we get down to business, so what are you going to do to prepare to win another championship?
We'll be on the dyno for sure. We got to get some more horsepower out of these V-Rods. It's getting down to crunch time with the last two races in Vegas, Pomona. I went out there in the final. I wanted to have a 40 light, had a 45. She just got the best of me with a 10 out there. So, we're real happy. We tuned it up for the final, ran 700s quicker than we did in the semi, so we can't be all that bad.
All right, thank you, Andrew. Over to Gary Gerald.
Well, Dave Conley, you're in very select company. The last time somebody won four in a row, it was the guy that you just defeated 3 years ago. You've said, if it's going to be, it's going to be. I mean, what do you say at this amazing role that continues and with really good fortune there as they shut Greg down?
Yeah, it's crazy. That's definitely not the way we wanted to beat him in the final. But you know what? This Torco Race Fuels team did an awesome job all day long to even get to the final. So, I'm still going to take this Wally home with us. And, it's all to, Evan Nola, Trail Press, and all the great people at Torco. They give us a sponsor. Ship to come out here, give Victor the fundings to put a team together like we do. I mean, John Utt, Tommy Utt, Craig Campton, Keith, the truck driver, all them guys, they bust their butts, and they're the ones who put the Chevy Cobalt in the final. So I've been a little under the weather today, but this definitely puts a smile on my face. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Well, let's go back up to the starting line now. He has Greg Anderson.
As they clean up a small drip of oil leaking out the bottom of your car. Greg, to get out run is one thing, but to not have a chance, entirely another.
I know, that's certainly not the way we wanted to end the day. We needed to win bad, and I think we had to give them a heck of a run there, but it doesn't matter. Obviously, we made a small mistake, and like I said, you can't make a mistake in this countdown, and we just did. So hopefully we can recover from it. Not a lot of time to recover in the countdown, obviously, but there's just bigger things on everybody's mind today, I guess. We're all worried about John Force. We love the man. He's everything to Powerade Drag Race. He's our Dale Earnhardt, I hope and I think everything's going to be all right, but I guess our minds are just there, and that's where they should be right now. That's more important than anything.
Now, priorities seem awfully good there with Greg Anderson. The pro stock points right now, Dave Conley, Greg Anderson, we told you they have clinched the first and second position. But Mike Dunn's still a little open there at the bottom.
Oh, yeah, there definitely is. And Greg made a great point. Right now, you can't afford to make mistakes in the countdown. He's got that cushion with the countdown to four. But when it gets down to the countdown to one, you cannot have a mistake like that. He knows it.
And we do want to send you away for this break with just a little more joy as you watch on the right side of your screen Peggy Llewellyn take her first ever win, grabs her first Wally, and tears of joy flow and the celebration begins. We'll have the Nitro Finals when we come back.
ESPN's presentation of the O'Reilly NHRA Fall Nationals brought to you by O'Reilly Auto Parts. Better parts at better prices every day. And by TGI Fridays Restaurants, where the three-course menu is back. Give me more Fridays.
Team Pedregon, Tony and Cruz, this is the final in Funny Car. Huge moment here, especially for Tony, as he continues to move forward in the countdown. Now, if you've just joined us, perhaps you will note that John Forrest could have been here, but a little bit earlier, Mike Dunn, we had a horrific accident.
Yeah, we absolutely did. It was earlier in the day when John's car looks like he basically, if you look at the right side of the screen, he's going to come over, flip a block out there, and then possibly just cause the tire to go down, and then actually pulled the back of the chassis off, and then the front of it went careening into Kenny Bernstein, a frightening incident.
Well, John Force was airlifted to Baylor Hospital. He has broken legs, he has an injury to his arm, and a possible concussion, but he was awake, alert, and talking as they, in fact, giving orders as they loaded him into the helicopter. First time that all Team Pendragon have been to a final round as teammates. Tony has never won here at Dallas. If he does win, he can go to first in the countdown.
You got two former Power A champions going at it right now. Cruz Pendragon not in that countdown to the championship. Tony Pendragon is. We asked about team orders. I don't think there's going to be right now. I think Cruz is hungry for a win. We'll see what happens.
Oh, tires light up there on the right side. A little drift over toward the center line for Tony Pendragon. But Tony Pendragon keeps it in his lane and takes the win. A 5:01 at 254 miles an hour.
Take now a look at Cruz Pendragon's going to spin the tires about 250 feet off the starting line. But look at Tony, almost gave it away. Remember, if you cross that center line or go over it with the rear tire, you're automatically disqualified. But Tony knew that thing was heading over there. He knew if he stayed in the throttle, it probably was going to carry it over. He did the right thing and shut it off and got the win.
So as he rolls to a stop, he can savor his 35th Funny Car career win and number one in the points. The last time he was there, number one, was in 2003. And back up at the line, Top Fuel, its final round. Bob Vandergriff and Larry Dixon. Let's go to Gary Gerald at the far end. He has, Tony.
You've just joined Snake. Don the Snake Prudhomme with 35 career wins in this category and number one in the points. A lot of things churning around, and I know you're concerned for John Force today. Explain the feelings if you can right now, Tony.
I'm going to try to get through this one. It's a big day. Anytime the Pendragon brothers can get in the final, big day for all the people with brown skin and all the sponsors, the Maloof brothers, Larry Miner, Stan Herzog, Palms Hotel, Mr. Gasket, Q Horsepower, Snap-on Tools. But I get a little emotional because I know John's going to be okay, but I'm going to stick around town. It's probably the first time anybody's ever dedicated a trophy to him, but I'm going to stay in town. I'm going to go see my friend if they'll let me in there. Hope he's okay. All our best to the family, and O'Reilly put on a good show. But, man, I love racing my brother. I thought during the burnout, my dad would be proud, and just kind of like to get over and see John, make sure he's doing okay.
Thanks, Tony.
You got it.
So thoughts there for John Forrest as he picks up his Wally. Back at the line, Larry Dixon. Can be his second win here at this event if he can take the win. But really, this is even much more about that man, Bob Vandergriff, who is trying to finally win a final. This will be his 11th attempt. He's never done it. That's a record all by itself. First time he went to a final was against Larry Dixon, huh?
And Bob, I was talking to Jim Dupuy, Bob Vandergriff's crew chief. He told me they're very satisfied with their hot weather setup, said they haven't made very many changes today. He says nobody expected them to be in the countdown, so all the positions that they can make up is just gravy.
Track temperature is still fairly comfortable. Vandergriff goes up in smoke. Larry Dixon goes on to the win. Larry Dixon, a 462, 310. And Larry Dixon scores his 41st race win, and that breaks his tie with Tony Schumacher for second on the all-time win list. Remember, Joe Amato still has the most at 52.
Wow, this is a tough break for Bob Vandergriff. I think he ran very good in the previous round, that 459, but lost lane choice to Larry Dixon's 455. That right lane just was not as good for the fuel cars out there in the middle of the track, and I think it pretty much cost him the win.
The Top Fuel points with Larry Dixon's win and a little fire on the left bank of the engine there. Larry Dixon is number one, followed by Hot Rod Fuller, Tony Schumacher, Brandon Bernstein, Bob Vandergriff, who had a shot at moving to within 1 point of the countdown to four, still sits back, but he still has a shot.
Well, and with 21 points, remember, qualifying is going to play into it when we get to Richmond, because he could possibly make that up if he can out-qualify Brandon, which would be big with the final race for the countdown to the championship.
Well, let's go to Dave Reif. He's with the car owner on Larry's car, Don Prudhomme.
At the side, you won your last Top Fuel and Funny Car race. Larry Dixon takes over the point lead here in the new era, first time since the Dick LeHay era.
Yeah, it's just been great. Donnie Bender and Todd Smith and the whole team's just doing a great job. But, you know, right now I'm thinking about John Force. That's a real tough deal. You know, he's just a major part of our sport. And to see something like that happen, it's... it's a shame, but I just wish him all the best. I love him to death.
Did that remind you a lot of yours in Indianapolis a long, long time ago with Jim Nicol?
Well, yes, it did. You know, to see a car cut in half like that, it's just awful. I mean, these cars are safe, but things can happen, you know? I don't know what to say right now. I mean, for something like that to happen to a guy like Forrest, it's unbelievable.
Everybody's thoughts are with him. Thank you, Snake. Down to the far end with Gary.
And Larry Dixon being congratulated, career win number 41, number one in the championship points. You never get tired of this, do you?
No, never at all. It's so hard to win one of these races. And, Todd Smith and Donnie Bender, everybody on the team had been doing such a great job. And Snake, he goes out there and tries to hustle the money for us to go out there and blow it all up. And, Powerade points and everything that went with it, it was a good day for Skytel, Lucas Oil, Torco, Accelerator, all of our, Goodyear, Ray Bestis, everybody that helps out, Mac Tools especially, Spy, all of them, and Summit. They do a great job for us, and I'm just proud to be driving this hot rod.
Congratulations one more time.
Hey, it's my daughter's birthday today, too. Happy birthday, baby. I got a gold man to bring home to you.
Oh, I'm glad you remembered that.
Thank you.
And we all say happy birthday. It's Larry's second win at this event. John Kernan.
So I'm down here with Bob Vandegrift. And Bob, I know you would have liked to have won that, but the bigger picture, we head to Richmond. You're only 21 points out of that top four.
Yeah, that is the important part. But, for the UPS team, man, that was right there for the taking, and we didn't get it. So it's disappointing, but, one of these days. I mean, I got a beautiful wife, healthy kids. I got it better than 99% of the people in this world. I'm not complaining about losing the damn drag race.
All right, Bob, thank you very much, and good luck at Richmond.
So there it is. It's all wrapped up. Pro Stock Motorcycle, they are set. The next time we see them is when we race at Las Vegas. They won't be at Richmond. And at Richmond in 2 weeks, that's the time when everything gets decided for the rest of the pro categories.
Yeah, and it should be a wild time there, like we talked about with Bob Vandegrift. Qualifying will play an important part for some of these drivers. Funny car, top fuel, everybody in there. As you look at the funny car points, Tony moves up there into that number one spot. John Force in that number four position. And then you got Ron Capps, Gary Selzy, Mike Gassi, and Jim Head rounding out the top eight.
And the question there will be the future of John Force with his injuries. And so the crowd now gets to walk the drag strip and remember this somewhat incredible day. So much happened here today, Mike Dunn.
Well, absolutely. Obviously, the incidents with John Force has overshadowed some great racing and some upsets. And, at this point, all we can do is just hope for and pray for John Force to have a fast and full recovery and back on the track.
Let's give you our final and latest update on John Force. It came as of 6 o'clock Dallas time. He's going to surgery at Baylor Hospital. He has a compound fracture of his left ankle. His right knee has an abrasion down to the bone, and he has suffered possible tendon damage there. His left wrist is dislocated and broken. He has abrasions and broken fingers on his right hand. He did have a CAT scan, and it did come back negative. His family, his friends are all right there with him. In fact, I'm sure at the hospital by now, they are a little bit tired of everybody calling to see how John Force is. But make sure you put John in your prayers. You know that he's barking out orders to everybody there. He is, in fact, one unique character. Well, our next qualifying show, October 6th, it comes from Richmond. Coming up next, it'll be the 2007 World Series of Poker presented by Milwaukee's Best Light. I'm Paul Page. For all the rest of our crew, Mike Dunn, Dave Reef, John Kernan, and Gary Gerald, John Force, get well, buddy.